Blog Talk Radio.
Third generation physician, general, and child psychiatrist, Dr. Francis Kress Welsing, mentioned your theory of white genetic annihilation. Not everybody is a believer in that theory. A guest that was recently on my program, Mr. Tim Wise, admitted racist, shared his thoughts on your theory, and I'm quoting him directly. He said it was pseudo-scientific BS. I was just curious if you had any thoughts on what Mr. Wise had to say.
Well, I think that that's fascinating and interesting in that Mr. Tim Wise says he is white. He says he is racist. And so it stands to reason that he would seek to discredit a black person who has an analysis of racism, white supremacy. Do you see, in pseudoscience, I'm not, you know, he would have to explain what he's talking about, but he's not a scientist, according to what I understand. Do you see, but he seems to be attacking what I say is the core. See, just to talk about racism, white supremacy is one thing, but until you get to the level of saying, in other words, to describe what goes on in a system of white supremacy is one thing. To understand why people who classify themselves as white need to engage in these behaviors is critical to understanding the brain computer of people who classify themselves as white. And until you get to an understanding as to why do people behave in the way that they do, you really can't, in a masterful way, counter what it is that they're doing. And so I'm not surprised at all that he would say something like pseudoscientific bullshit, pardon the expression. You see, it's not surprising at all. It's just more revealing of what he has admitted about himself. I am white, and I am racist. You see, so even though part of his behavior towards black people is, you know, I'm out here helping black people. But in reality, if he is attacking the only psychiatrist in the world who for the last 40 years has been talking about racism, white supremacy, the only person who has explained racism, white supremacy at the depth that I talk about it, as the fear of white genetic annihilation and the determination for white genetic survival, just based on the absolute science of genetics and the absolute demographics that exist on planet Earth. You see, so by his statements, he is saying, I actually want to maintain white supremacy, but in the meantime, I'm going to deceive black people and make them think they have a friend. What a friend I have in Jesus.
Is racism hurting you? On issues of race, are you unable to speak, think, and act with clarity and confidence? Are you tired of laughing when nothing is funny, smiling when you are not happy, agreeing when you really disagree? counterracism.com, you can learn specific strategies and techniques to counter the behaviors of the people who practice racism in all areas of activity. Using words correctly, following counter-racist logic, even counter-racist science projects designed to reveal what racism is, how it works, and how to counter it. The open source code writing format allows you to pick and choose from a variety of counter-racist suggestions so you can produce the code that works for you. Stop by counterracism.com today and help replace racism with justice.
That's counter-racism.com.
Okay, I think we are there. We had some technical difficulties. As usual, suspected interference. Persevere nonetheless. I think I'm back. I have my audio and we should be good to go. Context of racism. White supremacy as usual. Gus T Renegade and Justice in for another episode. I want to check to see if we have our guest. Mr. Wise, is that you?
Yes, it is. How are you?
I'm well. How are you, sir?
I'm doing just fine.
Outstanding. Thank you for spending some of your Sunday evening with us. Want to hop right in because I know we have a short time today. I believe... Justice is there with questions. Before we go to Justice, I wanted to get set for March.
Sure. Let me grab my calendar. Hold on.
Okie dokie.
All right. Okay. Shoot. Go ahead.
Are weekends better or weekdays or?
During the week, I'm traveling a lot, so weekends are typically better. I would say. Let's see. And Sundays, normally work fine if that works okay for you. I'm good for, let's say, I could do Sunday the 21st if that worked for you.
Would.
Or the 28th.
Would. Is the 14th out? Is that not possible?
Yeah, I'm on vacation with my family that day, unfortunately.
Okay, no problem. You said the 21st or the 28th, right?
Yeah, as far as Sundays go, right. Or, we could do Monday the 22nd or, but Sundays tend to, seem to be what we've done before, and that seems to have worked okay on both ends. So.
Okay. If that Monday is possible, could we do
okay.
that?
The 22nd? Which one? The 22nd? Yeah.
Okay. Monday the 22nd.
Same time?
4:30?
4:30 your time. Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Monday the 22nd at, so that's 6:30 Central, 4:30 p.m. Okay, Pacific. Outstanding. Will we have the full program that time, the full two hours?
Yes, we absolutely can. Sure.
Outstanding. Okie dokie. Beautiful. Got that taken care of. Next thing, since we're going to be hanging out once a month until July, you are a white person, admitted racist system of white supremacy. I would like to kind of compensate for some of the extra credibility and power that you have as a white person since we are non-white. I generally reference you as Mr. Wise. Justice and myself were on a first-name basis. I think you would be it would be cool if we could all be on a first-name basis, if that's acceptable with you.
That would be fine, yeah.
That's okay?
Sure.
Outstanding. Okay. Outstanding. Last thing, I want to go to Justice to see if she has some questions. It would also be helpful to compensate. I really make an effort to run a courteous and professional broadcast, and I want to give you ample time to respond and make your statements or ask questions if you have any. I would like to request if I could get two interjections. I don't want to call them interruptions, but just two interjections. If I want to call out something specific or if it's a really critical detail that I would like to point out, I don't want it to be like I'm just jumping in to interrupt you, so I want to request up front if I can get two For the duration of the program, I'll keep track so that I'm announcing. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Outstanding. Contact of White Supremacy, Timothy, Gus, Justice, Rock and Roll Justice, if you have some questions.
What makes you a racist white supremacist?
I think that the thing that makes me, as I've said before, at one level a racist or white supremacist is that, just like any white person who's raised in this culture, I too have been exposed to, been propagandized by, been conditioned to have certain beliefs, attitudes, thoughts, and occasionally behaviors which manifest and elevate white people at the cost of or at the expense of non-white people. I'm not saying that that's all that I have in me as a character or that that's the entire sum of who I am, but I think that I have internalized those beliefs, and that, in my opinion, and using the definition of that term racist, white supremacist that I'm operating from, is what would qualify me in my mind to be in that category, is having been exposed to those things and having internalized them just like anybody who's exposed to them.
So that is what makes you a racist?
Yes, I would say those are the things that make me and all white folks, I think, in this culture, at one level or another, racist or white supremacist. Not all at the same level. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Thank you for answering the question, but I was just asking.
Cool, that's great.
Do you have some more questions, Justice?
What is a white person?
A white person is someone who is capable of being defined as white in a system of white supremacy and racism. So anyone who can be classified that way, which over time that has changed. I mean, historically, some people, you know, many years ago were not considered white, now they are. So the definition over time has changed. I think that at any given time, like right now in 2010, anyone who is capable of being thought of as white, capable of being seen as white, capable of being treated as white and getting certain benefits or advantages from that is white. 100 years ago, who would have qualified would have been different. Like Italians wouldn't have been thought of as white 100 years ago the same way. Jews wouldn't have been thought of as white 100 years ago. The Irish, in many cases, weren't considered white. But now, all of those groups are. So the definition has changed, but I think it just is basically whatever the people in positions of power decide is white is what white is. And that's historically been people who are white. They get to choose, historically, who is in and who is out.
Okay, I'll be off for now.
Groovy. Okay. The non-white female, she called the previous broadcast last month Cree counter-racist evolving engineer. She has an excellent counter-racist program right here at Blog Talk Radio. She made a request the last program, if you could try to recall some times when you have consciously, willfully practiced racism, white supremacy. If you remember that request, if you were able to think of, okay.
I do remember it, and I went back to try to be as accurate as I could. And I looked at, I take a lot of notes on a daily basis, keep journal entries, and have done that for about 15 years, trying to keep track of the times that I collaborate with racism, the times that I fight back, the times that I drop the ball, the times that I don't drop the ball, et cetera. And I also try to keep track of any time that I do something that I think is racist and white supremacist, whether it's, you know, deliberate or whether it's not, just the effect. And as I went back, I looked at notes going back literally 15 years, and I was unable to come up with anything that is clearly evidence of intent or deliberate attempt to injure. But what I came up with that may be close, and so I'll share this because I'm not sure how she would classify it or how you would, but it's worth commenting on. There were times that I can recall and that I had written down, in fact, from the days when I had begun to do racial justice work, when I was an activist in college, for example, where the strategies that I was pushing, the tactics that I was pushing for the anti-racist work that I was trying to do, were tactics that I think I knew were dangerous and would be especially dangerous for people of color if they were to follow them, and yet I pushed them anyway. Now, that's not quite the same as saying I intended for people of color to do them and be harmed, but I think I was very cavalier about choosing the tactics, and even when I realized that those tactics could have been dangerous for people of color, much more so than me or other white folks, I went ahead and did them anyway. So that's not quite accidental. It's not quite intentional. I would say that's closer to the intentional side, even though I'm glad that, frankly, folks of color in that situation were too smart to follow what we were doing, and they didn't do what we were doing, which I think was a good thing. But that would be as close as I can come to a time when I seriously had some forethought and still practiced a form of racism, choosing a tactic that I knew could be dangerous for people of color.
Okay. I just want to make sure I'm clear. You said you did go back, you keep a journal, you take notes on a daily basis, you checked your notes,
right,
checked your journal, and that was the one example that you were able to come up with of a time that you willfully, consciously practiced racism, white supremacy, mistreating someone who is not white, mistreating someone because they are not white. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, again, it wasn't that I was mistreating someone per se, but I was doing something which I knew if folks of color did this, it could be injurious to them, and I did not stop from doing that. So to me, as far as I'm concerned, that counts. Now, I don't know whether that necessarily fits the caller's meaning, but that was the closest that I can find to something where I would say it was intentional or willful. There are plenty of instances, which I've talked about and written about before, where I definitely dropped the ball, was cavalier, didn't think, you know, through what I was doing, and ended up furthering, I think, racism in the process. But as far as something that would be close to intentionality, that is the, and there were a couple of times, but they were both around the same subject, the same tactics, the same student activism that I was doing when I was in college. And just to, so I'm not vague, it was work that we were doing around apartheid in South Africa, and specifically tactics that we were choosing as student activists to try to get our college to divest from companies that were continuing to prop up apartheid in that country. And the tactics we chose, like taking over board meetings, potentially getting arrested, going on hunger strike, these real cavalier kind of activist radical tactics were not thought out, and I was mostly to blame for choosing them. So to the extent that I knew people of color, if they did that, they would be in a lot more trouble than I would, and I still did it, I have to take some responsibility for that.
Okay. Very interesting. I would like to play a brief clip from our last broadcast when you were here on the COW.S in January, and I'll offer a thought or two, and then I'll ask for your thoughts on what you hear. So this is a brief clip. Mr. Timothy Wise, Justice Gus T. Renegade, from the January 28th, 2010 broadcast.
I just said, are you a racist?
Oh, okay. I thought there was something before that because there was about 20 seconds of silence. Well, you know, as I've said before on Gus's program, I have, as a white person growing up in this culture, internalized certain elements of racist and white supremacist thinking, no question about it. I've talked about that, written about that. I distinguish
Excuse
that.
Excuse me, I just want yes or no.
Well, see, but that's not the way human psychology works. The way I've answered the question before, and I will answer it again, whether one likes the answer or not, is that I have internalized aspects of racist thinking, as I would suggest every white person in the system of white supremacy has done. Now, that is different, however, from saying that I believe in, support, and advocate the system of racism and white supremacy, which I actually reject and attempt to fight against. But I would be dishonest if I did not acknowledge that I, like every other white person, have internalized certain aspects of racist thinking. I've always said that, but I do not believe that is the same as saying, as I think some believe it is the same as saying, that I therefore support actively and advocate for the system of racism, which is a system that I find deplorable, actually.
The words that you're using, I do not understand.
Why is that?
And all I need is just a yes or no. Are you a racist? Yes or no?
See, but that's not how human psychology works. It is not a yes or no question.
Whatever you call it.
Psychology? Psychology is the way that the brain functions. It's the study of the brain. And
I don't
the way
want
that,
the brain functions or anything like that. All I want is just a yes or a no.
Right, but it's not a yes or no question. And so you're going to be frustrated if you ask me that question. I've answered the question in very basic English, and I'm quite certain that you do understand. But I know that we like to play games on the show sometimes. And so I'm going to suggest that this is a very simple answer. I said I have internalized aspects of racist thinking. Now, if you want to take that as a yes to your question, feel free to do it. But I've also said that I have also internalized anti-racist thoughts, anti-racist norms, anti-white supremacist thinking, because even though I was exposed to racist ideas, and those have affected me like they've affected everyone, I was also taught to be an anti-racist, and so I've internalized that as well. So the best way that I can answer your question is to say that I have both internalized racist ideas and anti-racist ideas. Whether that makes me a racist in your estimation, you know, that's for you to decide. I'm simply saying it's part of who I am. It is not all of who I am.
You're just saying just buckets and buckets of words.
Again, context of white supremacy, that was from the January 28th program with Tim Wise, Justice Gus T Renegade. Several things stick out to me from that sound clip, and several of them, I would suggest, these might be examples of you practicing racism, white supremacy, consciously. I could be incorrect, but I wanted to get your thoughts. The first thing, you said, I know we like to play games on this show. Can you tell me exactly what you mean when you said, I know we like to play games on this show?
Sure. What I was referring to was the fact that over the times that I've been on the program, there seems to be a tendency to ask questions that are supposedly yes or no questions about whether someone's racist or white supremacist without first offering up front, before the question is even asked, what the definition is that's being used prior to the question being asked. And so when I'm asked that question, but I'm not sure as to what the asker of the question or the listeners is thinking, I may very well be thinking one thing, they may be thinking another, and it seems to me that it comes across or has come across to me, and I, like you just said, you could be wrong, I could be wrong, but it has come across to me in the past programs as something that is done tactically, that it isn't just an oversight, that there is an assumption that if you ask that question and it's answered a certain way, it becomes a gotcha moment that will be used indefinitely to discredit the person who is the guest on the show. To me, that seems like a game, because in fact, I don't think that we're maybe using the exact same definition, because sometimes it seems to suggest that racism requires intent, and other times it seems, I was on your program,
gotcha
the first
moment.
Time. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
What's a gotcha moment?
Oh, I'm sorry. When I say gotcha moment, I mean it's a moment where once an answer is provided, that will become the kind of thing that the host or others on the show or perhaps listeners will use to therefore discredit everything that is said after. It's sort of like saying gotcha, you know, like you admitted this, and now anything you say is pretty much irrelevant and, you know, not worthy of being listened to. And what I was saying was that from the very first time I was on the program and I admitted, quote unquote, to being racist white supremacist, I was admitting to exactly the way I explained it, which is internalizing certain racist beliefs. But I think, based on my listening to the program and other programs of Gus's, other Cal's programs, and later definitions that were provided to me either via email or even over, I believe, the second show, that actually the definition in the host mind, I think, and I could be wrong, is that it requires conscious intent to injure or to harm people of color, non-white peoples. And that is not what I was admitting to. But I feel as though once I've admitted to it the way I define it, it's almost like it doesn't matter how I define it. Now it only matters how the show defines it, and it's as if I've admitted to that when really I've admitted to something else. So I don't know whether it's a game or not. It has come across to me as seeming and feeling like a bit of a game. That's what I meant.
Okay. I'm pulling out my highlighter here for listeners, and based on what you just said, I'm going to submit that as Exhibit A, his statement that we like to play games on this show, as Exhibit A of a conscious and deliberate act of racism, white supremacy. That's what I suspect. I could be wrong. You indicated on the program in January that you feel this program is constructive. You also indicated that you earn upwards at times of $4,000 to go out and give lectures, speak about racism, white supremacy. You said you've been doing this work for 20 years. You've written books. You have two blogs. You are not ignorant about racism, white supremacy, certainly not ignorant about how to speak accurately, correctly, in a non-confusing manner about racism, white supremacy. If you had any ambiguity, any lack of certainty about what I meant when I used the term, I'm very certain all you had to do was say, hey, wait a minute, Justice. Wait a minute, Gus. Let's get your definition of racism so we can be very clear. And then, hey, if I don't agree with your definition, this is my definition. And I can either admit to being a racist by your definition, or I can agree, or I can admit to being a racist by my definition. That's what I would do. I know I'm a non-white person, a victim of racism, white supremacy. I am a black person specifically, so I'm subjected to the worst forms of racism, white supremacy. And I at least have enough clarity about speaking about racism, white supremacy, that I just ask someone if I have any suspicions about the terms that they're using, if I think we might have a different definition, I just ask, what do you mean when you use the term? Like, I didn't really know what you meant when you said playing games on the program. Justice didn't really know what you meant when you said a gotcha moment. You just asked. So I'm quite certain you could have asked, what do you mean when you say racist? You could have even done that with Justice on the last show. So I'm going to submit that as Exhibit A, as a conscious moment of racism, white supremacy, by Mr. Tim Wise. I suspect. I could be wrong, but that's just what I suspect based on your answer right there. The second thing from that clip, pretty much tying in right to this, in the letter that you wrote to me in May of 2009, or in one of the two letters that you wrote to me, you said the first time you interviewed me, you asked me whether I was a racist white supremacist. And I said, as I recall, yes, of course. I have a very difficult time with you taking, and I mean that clip for folks who didn't hear the program, that dialogue between Justice and Timothy lasted about 10 minutes with her asking him, are you a racist? You never asked her if you had some suspicions that we were trying to be sneaky Negroes about the use of the term racist. You could have just asked her very simply, what do you mean when you say racist? And she could have explained, and then you could have answered according to her definition. So I would submit that as Exhibit B, as a conscious moment of racism, white supremacy. I could be incorrect. What are your thoughts with regards to the response, the exchange, rather, that you had with Justice on the last program about her asking if you are a racist?
Well, I would agree with part of what you just said and think that it is a legitimate criticism of the way that I handled the interaction, in that I should have asked that question. You are 100% correct. I should have done it. and that was my flaw and my fault in not doing so, because you're right. Had I done that, we probably could have had far better clarity. There wouldn't have been any confusion, and I will completely take responsibility for that. That's fine. I would disagree that it was a conscious or deliberate act of racism. I was not trying to injure anyone by interacting the way that I did. I was not trying to injure justice, did not certainly mean to do that, and if I in any way did that, I apologize for that. But you're right that I should have asked the question, and that is a thing that I think I didn't do, and I should have done it probably three episodes ago. We could have had a lot less confusion on my part, perhaps less confusion on everyone's part, had I done so. So, you know, you're absolutely right about that part. I think that that's a fair and legitimate criticism.
Fair. I'm going to keep calling that out every time, and I do this with everyone. I do it with myself. Words of as we illustration right here, live illustration. Words are very important. I try to be cautious about substituting the word fair. I think you know the implications of that term can also be a reference for fair-skinned system of white supremacy. I think I would prefer to use the term correct, accurate. I think it was an accurate criticism that I raised, and I think I'll stand by what I said. I think that would be my Exhibit B, of a conscious act of racism, white supremacy. And when I say racism, white supremacy, no, you did not injure her. It wasn't like you threw a brick at her.
Right.
But in my view, the principal tactic of racist white supremacists is deception, to cause confusion amongst the victims. And I definitely think, and you even said, you're going to be frustrated with the answer. You said that in the response. I definitely think that would be an example of causing confusion. And I would have to assume consciously, because that would have been easy. Super. Justice has already demonstrated at 10. If I have confusion or suspicion around the term, hey, wait a minute, what does that term mean? Very easy. And for someone who makes a living talking about racism, white supremacy, I gotta assume, since you didn't ask and didn't seek to clean that confusion up, I gotta assume that that was a conscious act of racism, white supremacy. I could be incorrect, though. The next thing I want to, I guess we can get clarity about this right now. When I say racist, white supremacist, I mean a white person who mistreats a person or persons directly, indirectly, consciously, unconsciously, because they are not white. When you were on the program on January 28th, 2010, you said, yes, I mistreat people and or persons because they are not white. I do this directly, indirectly, consciously, and or unconsciously. So with that as my definition for a racist white supremacist, would that definition fit you, Timothy?
Using that definition, and as long as it includes the unconscious or the not deliberate piece of it, then I would say my original answer of having said, yes, that is me, it's not all of who I am, but it's part, would be accurate. So in that sense, okay, we have agreement. And I was only asking the question now because I'd gone back. I think I might have mentioned to you in the email I sent today that I'd gone back and I'd come across a definition that was attributed to Mr. Fuller. And I don't, you know, and if it's not the accurate one, feel free to correct me because it could be wrong. But the one that I saw of how Mr. Fuller defines white supremacy, I mean, I found this site where his explanation was that there were three types of people: white, who are suspect racist, non-white, and then white supremacist. And the definition of white supremacist that was given or attributed to him on that site had something to do very clearly with intent or deliberate injury to non-white peoples. And if we were using that definition, not including the non-deliberate or the unconscious or the inadvertent injury, but deliberate intent to injure, then I would say that I do not admit to that. I do not believe that's who I am. And I would be in his classification, from what I'm understanding of his definition, a suspect racist, but not a white supremacist. But using the definition that you just used, which I think is somewhat different, and again, I could be wrong on that, then I would say yes, because the unconscious or the non-deliberate acts that I engage in, I am quite certain, have marginalized at times people of color, have elevated me as a white person. I don't think there's any doubt about that. And I've talked about that, written about that on this show and elsewhere many times. So using the definition that you just offered, then I think I fit that. I don't fit every aspect of it in the sense that deliberate and non-deliberate, conscious and unconscious. But I certainly would say that I am guilty of internalizing those beliefs and no doubt acting on the basis of that conditioning, whether I intend to hurt or not, causing some form of injury, and have done that at various points in my life. Absolutely. So that, if that's the definition, then I think we have agreement.
Okay. Okay. Outstanding. And I want to point this out for listeners as well. This is exactly why we brought up the concept of victims guaranteed qualification. Mr. Fuller is another slave on the bottom of the boat, just like me. He is an admitted victim of racism, white supremacy. He has his definitions. I'm not even certain if that is his definition for a racist white supremacist. I would have to double check the code book or give him a call, but I really don't need to. I have my own definition, and I would encourage any non-white person, victim of white supremacy, think about racism, white supremacy, and think about how you want to define terms that most accurately reveal truth. And once you get them and you're comfortable with them, use them until you find better definitions or better terms. So that we should have that squashed from henceforth forward. On this program, that's my definition of a racist, white supremacist until I get a better one, and you have agreed by that definition, yes, racist, white supremacist, Timothy Wise, should be no confusion about that forevermore. Justice, do you have some questions you would like to ask Timothy?
Why do white people want racist and white supremacy here?
I think it probably depends on the white person, but I think generally the reason that white folks want to see at some level or another racism maintained and kept alive is that we reap huge benefits from it. We reap economic benefits, more money, better jobs. We reap educational benefits, schools with more money spent on white students, for example, than schools that serve black students or Latino students or Asian students. We reap benefits in the criminal justice system. We're treated better by the courts, by police, so that whenever any group is treated better under a certain system, there is a sort of logic that that group is going to want to keep that going. And so I think that principally the reason that most white folks want to see it continue to operate is because it pays. It pays real benefits to people. And I would say that, I mean, I haven't polled, you know, I haven't done a survey of all the white folks to know, but that would be my understanding based on the conversations I have had, based on my own research, based on what evidence I've been able to see and come up with, that it is the desire to maintain power. It is the desire to maintain better opportunity over non-white peoples.
How does it feel to be white?
I think that to be white in the United States, and I don't know what it might feel like somewhere else, but to be white in the United States, which is the only place I've ever lived, is to know at a pretty deep level that there are things you can just take for granted and not worry about. For example, it means that I don't have to worry about having police stop me when I'm driving on the street because they suspect me of having done something, either, you know, possessing drugs or having committed a crime or that kind of thing. It means knowing that if I go to a bank to get a loan for a house or something, that I'm not going to be looked at by the bank officer as someone who probably can't even afford a house. They're going to give me the benefit of the doubt. They're going to think that I'm a good investment and probably give me the loan. It means that in school, I can take for granted that teachers are probably going to look at me as if they think I am more capable than the non-white student who might be sitting right next to me in the classroom. So to be white is to have this sense of confidence, I think. Certainly this is what it has meant for me, to have a sense of confidence that you're going to be treated better in almost every situation. There might be a few times when you're still treated badly, but generally speaking, It is to be able to take for granted that you will be treated better than people who are not white.
Okay, I'll be off for now.
Okay.
Context of white supremacy justice. Gus and Timothy, the anniversary, 1 year
Hold
anniversary
up,
at Blog Talk. I'm sorry?
Sorry, I just got one more. Sorry,
okay.
I just got one more.
Go right ahead. Go right ahead.
What do you like about being white?
Well, that's a great question, actually. What I like about being white, obviously, is the ability to take for granted that I will have opportunity. I think anyone who has opportunity likes that. At the same time, you know, as I've said before, it bothers me deeply that I live in a society that gives me better opportunity because I don't think that's fair. I don't think it's right. And I'd rather live in a place where opportunity was equal. But I can't deny that it feels good to have opportunity and to know that there are certain things that if I want to do them, the odds are I'll be able to do them. So the thing that I like about it, probably like any white person, is having those advantages. In my case, I'd like to see those advantages shared and equally distributed amongst everyone. I wouldn't have to give up my ability to have opportunity for other people to have opportunity, but I certainly enjoy the opportunities that I have, and that would be probably the best way I can answer that question.
Okay, that'll be all for now.
Okay.
Okie dokie. Again, context of white supremacy, justice, Gus, Timothy, and for the 1 year anniversary of the COWS at Blog Talk Radio, 99th broadcast at the COWS here at Blog Talk Radio. Okie dokie. When we were on the January 28th program, I could have made this a sound clip, but I didn't. It was either myself or Justice, I think it was most likely myself, used the term victim of white supremacy, and you said that you all like to use that term. And I just wanted to ask if there's anything incorrect about referencing any non-white person in the system of white supremacy as a victim of racism, white supremacy.
Oh, no, I think that's a fair term, and I don't think I object.
Fair, you said it again.
Sorry about that. I think it's an accurate term. I think it is a legitimate claim, and I don't think that I took objection to it. I certainly am not objecting to it right now. I think that is true, that any non-white person, any person of color under white supremacy is victimized by it, no question. No question.
Oh, okay. Just wanted to check. Do you think that there is a more accurate label for a non-white person under the system of racism, white supremacy?
No, not really. I sometimes use the term target. I know there are some people, non-white folks, who have brought to my attention that they sometimes prefer target only because, you know, the target can it sometimes sounds as though the person has the ability to fight back more effectively than a victim who might, you know, a victim, sometimes people think victim is a term that takes away your agency and your ability to resist. I'm not saying that's true. I'm just saying some people feel that way. And so target is another word that I think is similar, but I think victim is a perfectly accurate one, or target or both, you know, either one.
Okay. Excuse me. As I emailed you, I said I wanted to make sure that we got clarity around definitions. I think that's real important. On this program, when I use the term racism and the term white supremacy, the definition that I use for both terms is as follows: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think that is an accurate definition for racism, white supremacy?
Well, see, here's the problem. That, to me, because it said dedicated to the injury or dedicated to the subjugation or whichever the verb was, that seems to not be consistent with the one you offered a minute ago about what a white supremacist is, which didn't necessarily imply dedication, which is an intended word. I mean, that's a word that implies intent. So I'm not sure how to answer that because it seems like those two don't quite jibe. I do believe that the system of white supremacy is one in which all white people, all people classified as white, by virtue of the privileges we receive and the mentalities that we internalize, definitely have the effect of subjugating and injuring non-white peoples. But it's the dedication piece that I think is the sticking point between you and I in terms of definitions, because to be dedicated to something means that's what I want to continue. And I'm claiming, and those who have been white historically who have tried to be allies in the struggle against white supremacy have all said that we don't want to see that system perpetuated, but we still know that we do contribute to it so long as the system is in place, even if we're fighting against it. So I'm not sure, you know? I mean, I'm not trying to...
Okay, wait, I'm going to use one of my interjections right here, my two, got one left. And I'm hopping in because I've heard this argument consistently, but the word allies just, from an admitted racist, the word allies just really sticks in my craw. The reason that I am just absolutely unwilling to part with dedicated at this point, really, this program, we've done 99 programs here at Blog Talk Radio, 99. Some of your comrades, alleged anti-racist, Dr. Peggy McIntosh, she has come through. Dr. Robert Jensen, he has been here twice. Noel Ignatiev, Jane Elliott, a myriad of 99 programs without a phone or a computer, I might add. And I have heard a lot of these white alleged anti-racists say that I don't like the term dedicated. It implies some sort of intent. It implies that white people are conscious. And I'm not saying dedicated for any of those reasons. I'm saying dedicated because the system is still here. There is plenty of evidence that non-white people have resisted and fought against racism, white supremacy, whenever the victims of white supremacy have attempted to replace this system of injustice, they have met overwhelming and crushing opposition from racist white supremacists. The logic in that implies the white people who believe in and practice racism, white supremacy, are dedicated to making sure this system stays in place. The logic that the system is still here, I mean, that just is overwhelming, that these people have got to be committed to seeing this stay in place. Now, have I said anything that is inaccurate, illogical?
Well, it's the problem is that you're saying that, I mean, I agree with you that there are people in the system who absolutely believe in its perpetuation, who want to see it perpetuated, and who are dedicated to it. The disconnect between me and you, I think, is that on the one hand, for those of us who acknowledge that racism and white supremacy is part of our makeup because of our conditioning, that doesn't mean that every white person who admits to that is dedicated to the system's perpetuation. The fact that the system is still here does not prove that the goal or the desire of those who claim to be fighting it is not sincere, because if that were the standard, then we would have to say that all of those non-white people who have led the fight all of these generations against white supremacy, since they too have failed, that they must also have been dedicated to its perpetuation just because it failed to change it. That, of course, would be silly. So all I'm saying is, yes, there are people like that. But I think the problem is that if the implication, and if I'm misunderstanding what you're claiming, feel free to tell me. If the implication is that all white people who admit at any level at all to having internalized white supremacist beliefs must therefore be dedicated to its perpetuation, that I disagree with. That doesn't mean there aren't people like that, however, who are dedicated to it. I'm just saying that does not necessarily hold for all white people in that system.
Okay. And I think
Hello. Did we lose audio again?
Can I be heard?
I can hear you now. There was just about 20
okay.
seconds where I couldn't.
Okay, outstanding. I said, I believe this is another great demonstration of the importance of refining your words and definitions that you use to attempt counter-racism. I believe my definition for a racist white supremacist reflects that I feel a white person can unconsciously practice racism, white supremacy. However, my definition for the system of racism, white supremacy does not in any way reflect unconsciousness or a lack of intent, because I believe the overwhelming evidence suggests that the people who believe in and practice this system of white supremacy, they are committed to seeing it stay in place forever. Whenever it has been resisted, whenever the non-white people have got themselves together and tried to get rid of this, they have been squashed. And the white people who believe in and practice racism have resorted to any means to squash that effort. So I think, I don't really think there's a problem. I don't think there's anything inaccurate. I don't think there's anything illogical about the use of the term dedicated. I think the way I have defined both of those two terms separately, racist and system of racism, it completely allows for the unconscious racist white supremacists, that in no way negates the fact that this system is maintained by people who are for sure dedicated to seeing it stay in place. And again, I just want to ask, is that inaccurate, illogical?
No, thank you for that clarification. Based on what you just said and that clarification and explanation, I think what you said is perfectly logical.
Okay. Can you, 'cause there might be a better one, and I allow for that too. What definition do you use for racism, white supremacy?
I would define racism and white supremacy as two things. And one is ideological, one is systemic. And the reason I do that is that racism, like any ism, ends with those three letters. And every term you can think of pretty much that ends with ism is two things, a system and an ideology. At the level of ideology, racism, white supremacy, is the belief in the superiority of people defined as white and the inferiority of people defined as anything but white. And maybe that might be viewed in biological superiority terms, or it might be viewed as cultural superiority. Either way, to me, it's racism, white supremacy at the ideological level. At the systemic level or the institutional level, it would come closer to what you just said as your definition. And it's very simply, to me, a system of inequality based on race, where all persons defined as white are elevated by law, by custom, by policies, by practices, procedures, social mores, everything, are elevated above non-white peoples or peoples of color. So it's a system of inequality based on race, with whites elevated above non-whites.
Okay. I like mine better.
Okay.
Folks who are listening in, you know, I'm sure there are people who are listening in and say, I don't like Gus's, I'm going to use Timothy's. That's fine, too. That's what you should do if you're going to practice counter-racism. Check out what different people, the terms that they use, strategies, suggestions, pick and choose. He makes $4,000 to talk about this, and that's his definition. I have no phone, no computer, and you heard my definition, so pick what you want. Justice, do you have questions that you would like to ask Timothy?
Are you now willfully, deliberately, and by personal choice maintaining comradeship with any person who you have reason to believe is a racist white supremacist?
No, if we are using the definition that implies intentionality. If we're using Gus's definition, if we're using my definition, and I assume we are,
then I'm sure the answer would be yes, in that there are people who practice it and who are, I'm sure, practicing it in some way indirectly, just like I do, with whom I am in contact and with whom I am friends and that kind of thing. So, I mean, the answer is no if it's people who are intending to harm or deliberately doing it, but it's yes if the answer is someone like myself who knows that he is or she is perpetuating injustice and inequality in the system of white supremacy. So it all depends on, again, the terminology or the way we're looking at it. That's the best I can do on that.
What exactly is said in that conversation between two white people where one white person is attempting to get another white person to stop practicing racism, white supremacy?
To stop practicing? Did you say to stop practicing racism, white supremacy?
I said to get another white person to stop practicing racism, white supremacy.
That's a great question. In my experience, the way that conversation has gone is typically, and I'll give you one real clear example. When I have been in situations where people have made racist comments, told racist jokes, said things that were clearly racist, white supremacist, my response in an attempt to get them to stop that and to stop thinking in the way that leads them to act on that basis and to say those things has typically been to do two things. Number one is that I challenge the statement or the joke directly. I don't let it stand. I'm not saying that I've never failed to respond, but I try very hard to always respond in that moment. And when I do two things. Not only do I challenge whatever the racist thought was that was said, let's say it was a joke that was told about someone who was black or someone who was Asian. Not only will I challenge that part of the statement, but I also try to challenge that white person to think about what it means that they shared that joke with me because they assumed that I would be okay with it. In other words, what I'm saying to them is, why is it that you assume that I will be okay with a racist joke or a racist comment? And then I proceed to say that, in my opinion, when they do that, they're actually being disrespectful to white people and disrespecting their own group because they're assuming that every white person wants to hear that kind of comment, that we all agree with it, that we're all okay with it, and that therefore, in a way, they've disrespected themselves. They've just basically said that all white people are bigots who want to hear racist humor. And what I have found is that when I say that, when I challenge them on that, and that's our conversation, it actually, in many cases, has been productive because they will admit that that they just assumed that it would be okay. They had never or rarely ever been challenged by another white person for making a racist comment. And so once they've been challenged by a white person, it very clearly sort of affects them in terms of what they think they can get away with. So that's normally what I do. I don't know what other people do, but that's the kind of conversation that I have with people in that situation.
When white people mistreat non-white people, what are some of the things non-white people can say or do to be helped?
That they can say or do to the white person or amongst themselves?
To a non-white person.
To another non-white person.
Do you want me to repeat the question?
Well, I just wanted some clarification. Did you mean what can a non-white person who's a victim of that say to another non-white person to help themselves, or what can they say to a white person to help themselves? I just wasn't clear.
It's the things non-white people can say or do to be helped.
Okay. What I think, and I hope I'm getting you right here, what a non-white person can do, let's say first, in a situation where they're being injured or harmed by a white person, the first thing I think is that a non-white person, a person of color in that situation, needs to find strength in numbers amongst other people who are non-white, who are people of color, for the purpose of solidarity. A lot of times what I have found is that non-white people in workplaces or schools, for example, or communities where they are being injured by white supremacy, oftentimes express the belief that they feel as though they're alone, that they feel that they can't speak up, that they can't say anything, that they can't challenge it because they feel isolated. They feel like they're the only one who sees the problem sometimes. They're afraid that if they speak out, people will think that they are crazy, that they don't know what they're talking about. And so the first advice is always to find strength in numbers, because when non-white people meet up and talk with other non-white people in that same institution, they often find that they have very similar stories, that they have very similar experiences, and they can support one another in getting through that experience and figuring out how to respond to it. But it's hard to do that if you don't know that there are other people going through what you're going through. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is to always keep in mind, for those who are the targets and victims of white supremacy, to always keep in mind that they are not the problem, that it is not the victim or the target who has the problem. They're not seeing things. They're not exaggerating things. They're not crazy. That, in fact, they are the ones who know exactly what they're experiencing, and they need to constantly remind themselves of that. Because, I mean, I've seen a ton of non-white folks who seem to question their own judgment about what they're experiencing, and I think that is one of the more disempowering things that happen. So I think that solidarity in numbers, finding other people with whom you can talk to about the problem, especially other non-white people who you can find strength in numbers with, is the key. And being clear on what one's experiences are. Document those experiences. Write them down. Keep track of them. Any kind of comment, any kind of incident that takes place on the job, in the school, whatever it is, write it down, document it, name, date, the time it happened, where you were when it happened, because what we know is that unless there is a clear sort of documentation trail of mistreatment, it's very hard to ever get any kind of justice in a school or in a workplace setting. You know, writing it down won't guarantee that you'll get justice and you know, that things will be corrected, but it certainly...
Any kind of justice?
I'm sorry, what?
What any kind of justice? What are you talking about?
Oh, I'm sorry. For example, in a workplace, if someone has been discriminated against, let's say someone who is a non-white person in a workplace setting applying for a promotion or something to get a better job, and let's say that they are treated badly by their supervisor, they are disrespected by their supervisor, and they have a reason to believe that perhaps the reason they didn't get the promotion was because of the color of their skin. It's important to document each incident that might lead a person to conclude that they were mistreated, because if there's any chance of obtaining justice, and by this I mean in that single setting, in the sense of getting, you know, the better opportunity that you deserved, not being passed over for the promotion, getting the opportunity that you earned, it's going to require some level of documentation. So I mean justice on the micro level, on the small level of in a given place, in a given time. Obviously, real justice requires the eradication of white supremacy, but on a day-to-day basis, people of color still need to be treated well, you know, on the job, in the schools. And to have that happen, it's important to document. I'm sorry, what?
What real justice? What are you talking about?
Well, real justice, I assume.
Justice or real justice? What's real justice?
Oh, I'm sorry. To me, the ultimate real justice, I mean, social justice and racial justice, requires the eradication of white supremacy in all institutional settings. However, until that day comes, I think it is also important for non-white people to fight for just and fair treatment in the schools, on the job, so that they're not being discriminated against on the job. Even if the system is still in place, everyday black and brown folks should still be able to fight for fair treatment on the job, in the schools, in the justice system, et cetera. So it's not, you know, ultimate justice is the eradication of white supremacy, But on a day-to-day basis, folks still have a right to fight for fair treatment. And that's why I say documentation is important, because oftentimes what we see is that people who are trying to get treated better in the schools, on the job, who don't have the documentation, they didn't write down what happened, when it happened, who said what to whom, find themselves unable to get any kind of compensation, unable to get any kind of justice at all, any kind of fair treatment. They continue to be ignored when they make those complaints. So I just think solidarity in numbers, documentation, keeping track of incidents that happen is important on a day-to-day basis.
Okay. Gus, do you think that he is practicing racism, white supremacy?
I suspect so. I suspect so, consciously and or unconsciously.
Okay.
Mr. White, I know you said one. Oh, I'm sorry.
What ways can white people help victims of racism, white supremacy?
That's a great question. I think there are a couple of things that white folks can do. First off, is that we have to be willing to challenge other white folks, particularly white folks in authority positions, people who make decisions in employment settings, on the job, in the schools, police, et cetera, whenever and every time that we see racism and injustice being perpetrated, we have to speak out. Now, I know that we won't do it every time. It often doesn't happen, but we need to try and resolve to make that happen. Always speak up, always challenge it, and not just challenge it because we're trying to do charity work. I think it's very important that white folks don't think of this as charity work. We are not, those of us who try to be allies, and I know Gus doesn't like the word, and I'm just saying try to be, need to realize that we have got to try a lot harder, and we have got to challenge a lot more forcefully, and we have got to challenge ourselves as well, because it's very easy to fall back into the patterns of silence and not doing anything. So it requires challenging, speaking out. It requires sharing information with non-white peoples that may be helpful to them. So if, for example, if I'm working in a job and I know there's a job opening and I know some of the inside information that might be helpful to a non-white person to be able to obtain that job, like what are the things they need to say in an interview? What are the things they ought to have on their resume? What are the things they need to know about the boss, you know about the company or whatever? I need to be sharing that information with people of color. Same thing in any institution. So speaking out, providing inside information that otherwise non-white people might not know, when we have that information, being open with that, and hopefully being accurate with that, and providing what we do know that could be helpful to a non-white person. So, for example, what I just tried to do in giving you that information about solidarity, about documentation, is an attempt on my part, however strong it may or may not have been, to provide some inside information about what I know to be helpful for white folks to do, or what I've seen be helpful in the past.
Okay, that'll be all for now.
Context of White Supremacy 1-year anniversary program. I know, Timothy, you said you had 1 hour, you had family obligations today. Do you have time for one question, or we can save it
until... I do have time for one more, and I'll be glad to do it.
Okay, outstanding. I bobbled. I meant to catch this earlier in the program when you referenced the quote, "We like to play games on this program," and you said that when you were explaining the gotcha moment that I guess Gus will look to get a white person to say that they are racist or admit to being a racist white supremacist. So that whatever they say from that point forward can be discarded, so that person is not listened to. I completely disagree with that, and I think the overwhelming evidence is totally contrary to that statement. This is your 1, 2, 3, third appearance on this program at Blog Talk Radio, your fourth appearance on the COWS in total. Farrell Winfrey, who is also an admitted racist white supremacist, has been on this program three times. Jane Elliott, admitted racist white supremacist, has been on this program twice. Jessica Pettit, admitted racist white supremacist, has been on this program twice. I think if the intent was to discard what you all have to say, I certainly would not have you back on the program repeatedly. And we're looking at a fifth trip next month. So I think the overwhelming evidence would suggest that that is not true at all. If anything, I would tell people to become razor sharp in listening to what these people have to say once they say they are racist white supremacists, just to make sure that they are not practicing racism and being confusing and or deceptive when they speak to you. And I think my conduct would exhibit that, or at least I hope so. The last question that I wanted to ask is just around that, in terms of being suspicious. When you were on the program last, you said that it would be constructive towards replacing white supremacy with justice if non-white people, as opposed to coming to you at the end of a presentation for a hug, a high five, an autograph, as opposed to that, they came with a high level of suspicion, they were asking questions, and they were extremely suspicious of your motivation, that you, hey, could be here to practice, refine, maintain the system of racism, white supremacy. It would be fabulous if you could explain to our listeners why that would be constructive towards replacing white supremacy with justice. And if you could give me your best A-plus answer, that would be a fabulous end to the program.
I will do my best, and then we can always pick that up again, you know, next time if you'd like. I think that the reason it's constructive for folks of color, non-white people, to be cautious and suspicious of any white person, myself included, who does this work and who claims and aspires to be an ally is really very simple. And that is that even if our intentions are good, the ability of a person who is white in a system of white supremacy to ultimately fall back into old patterns, to go with what we are familiar with, to fall back into the benefits that come, frankly, from white supremacy, the lure of that is great. And so, as I said the other night in a speech, and I actually made the point that I was asked a few shows back, I've been doing this lately, one of your callers had asked me to make that point in my presentations, and I did that. And one of the things, the way that I explained it then was, you know, we have, those of us who are white, we have too much stake in the game to trust that we will not drop the ball, even if we intend everything right, even if our intentions are good. And you can certainly be suspicious of those as well, but the fact is, even if they were good, we have too much stake in the game to simply trust that we will always stay on point. And ultimately, that means that allies are not what they say, it's what they do, and that the judgment has to be based on our actions, not just our words. And I said that in several, I said it in several speeches in a row now, and it's been very interesting, and we can talk more about the response that that's brought about the next time. But, you know, when I said that, it was very interesting. The reaction of the non-white folks in the audience was overwhelmingly agreement. I mean, heads nodded. There was verbal and audible recognition of the legitimacy of saying that. The only thing that was disturbing, and this is probably something we can probe more deeply next time, was that there were people who came up after who actually said, and this may not surprise you at all, even though it may concern you, and understandably so, people who came up, again, folks of color, non-white peoples, who came up, and it was almost as if me saying that, saying you shouldn't trust me, just like you shouldn't trust any white person, be cautious, be suspicious, it was almost as if they said, you know, that makes you even more credible because I said that. So it's like a weird sort of catch-22. If I don't say it, right, then people are too trusting. If I do say it, they know to be on guard, but at the same time, they extend even more legitimacy. So it's a strange thing. I still feel that it's helpful to point it out, but I do think that in a weird way, it can actually contribute to the credibility, you know, that we're trying to be cautious about. So it's an interesting sort of, you know, like I said, an interesting catch-22.
It's sad. It's sad, and it's not constructive in my view, and I think we're in agreement on that. It is not constructive if that is the result, and we'll pick back up on that on March 22nd, Monday, March 22nd, 6:30 p.m. Central, 4:30 p.m. Pacific. Admitted racist, white supremacist Tim Wise will make his fifth trip to the CO.W.S. Thank you for sharing your Sunday afternoon. Always constructive dialogue. Looking forward to March 22nd.
You bet, and congratulations on your one-year anniversary.
Thank you. Not a celebration. Means the job is not done, but thank you, sir, and we'll be in touch soon.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
Bye.
Context of White Supremacy, Justice, and Gus T. Renegade. We're going to take a quick commercial, and we'll be back, share a few thoughts, see what Justice has to say. She can give out her email. The CO.W.S. will be right back.
Is racism hurting you? On issues of race, are you unable to speak, think, and act with clarity and confidence? Are you tired of laughing when nothing is funny, smiling when you are not happy, agreeing when you really disagree? At counterracism.com, you can learn specific strategies and techniques to counter the behaviors of the people who practice racism in all areas of activity. Using words correctly, following counter-racist logic, even counter-racist science projects designed to reveal what racism is, how it works, and how to counter it. The open source code writing format allows you to pick and choose from a variety of counter-racist suggestions so you can produce the code that works for you. Stop by counterracism.com today and help replace racism with justice.
That's counter-racism.com.
We do not have Watermelon Day on the plantation here in the CO.W.S. Context of White Supremacy. I am not doing party favors, having cupcakes, no celebrations here in the CO.W.S. We're simply recognizing 1 year here at Blog Talk Radio. And really, the only reason I'm even acknowledging it at all is because I'm mildly astonished myself that this program has been here at Blog Talk Radio for 1 year, 99 programs with no phone, no computer. If I was in Master's house and had a few more trinkets and such and had a phone, I probably wouldn't even have made this much to do about today being the one-year anniversary. But not having a phone, not having a computer, and pulling off 99 programs, Mild accomplishment, but back to the cotton fields. Racism, white supremacy has not been replaced, so nothing to celebrate at all. Justice, did you want to give out your email address for folks?
Yes, justice.asap@yahoo.com. Again, justice.asap@yahoo.com. Nothing capitalized.
Outstanding. Shoot her email, please. Shoot her email. She loves it. Back of the bus. He was in the chat room on the not the chat. We don't have that. He was typing to me though, and he said that Mr. Wise, excuse me, Timothy, referenced non-white people as targets, and I said, hey, I am all right with that. If white people want to start calling non-white people targets, no problem. I feel like I have a huge bullseye on my back as a non-white person. I would not have any beef if they said, I don't want to call you a victim of racism, white supremacy. I want to call you a target. No problem. I would get a shirt with a bullseye and a little Sambo figure in the middle. No problem. And you can get double targets if you can hit the center and get a bullseye and hit the little Sambo, since I'm a black male.
Double whammy.
That's right. No problem at all. Would not upset me. I did want to point out, because I believe Lauren Ashley, she was commenting, and she said today is the 45th anniversary, or not anniversary, but 45 years ago today, to the day, the victim of racism, white supremacy, Malcolm X, was executed. And I did want to at least recognize that. And I wanted to read something. This is from Peter Goldman. He is a white man, suspected racist, and he wrote a biography on Malcolm X titled The Death and Life of Malcolm X. And the passage at the end I thought was pretty interesting. He writes, "Not every," and this is on the day Malcolm X was assassinated, "not everybody wept. The day Malcolm X died, Maya Angelou was in San Francisco, resting between Ghana on her commitment to the Organization of African American Unity, and was visiting an aunt when a friend called and said, 'Why'd you come back? These people are crazy. Why else did they kill that man?' She hung up numbly, and after a while, her brother came by for her. He didn't even phone. He just came and said, 'Let's go.' I was pretty out of it. He took me to a bar and ordered a drink and said to someone, 'You see what just happened to Malcolm X?' And the guy said, pardon the language, I'm quoting, it's important, pardon the language, 'Shit, you live by the sword, you die by the sword.' We went to another place and a guy said, 'Shit, man, he had it coming.' Today, if anybody, middle class, bougie, anybody, said anything against Malcolm X, he'd be stoned. But that day, my brother made me walk the gauntlet through the Fillmore District, the San Francisco Black Quarter, and it was the same everywhere. My brother said, 'These are the people that man died for.'" Again, this is from Peter Goldman's The Death and Life of Malcolm X. And I wanted to read that to, again, reiterate what I said on the program on Friday. Not really looking for validation. That's why I'm not celebrating. We're not having Watermelon Day on the plantation to recognize the one-year anniversary. It's just about replacing white supremacy with justice, not getting a pat on the back. Non-white people consistently display a lack of regard for other non-white people who attempt to replace white supremacy with justice. And then once the person has been killed and they've been gone for a while, then, you know, we'll act like that person meant something and their life really mattered. I'm not really into all that. I don't want, you know, flowers and any of that foolishness once I'm gone. I just want the system of racism, white supremacy to be replaced with a system of justice. I don't want a plaque. I don't want people wearing T-shirts with my name or any of that other foolishness. Just replace the system of racism, white supremacy with justice. And I think all of this goes back to what I said about not seeking that validation. I'm mentioning it again because I think it's huge. I think a lot of non-white people get caught up in looking for kudos and admiration, adulation. I mean, it's crushing being a victim of racism, white supremacy, especially if you are a black victim of racism, white supremacy.
Double whammy.
That's right. So I understand. But I truly believe if you're going to work to replace white supremacy with justice, it would be best to not look to think you're going to not expect a lot of love and appreciation for the work that you do. At that passage that I just read, I was stunned the first time that I read it, even though I knew Malcolm X faced a lot of criticism from black people, from non-white people who were very critical of him. did not support his efforts, criticized him for this, that, and the fourth. Martin Luther King Jr., same thing. I can't think of a non-white person who did not face just I mean, you can look at President Obama. It's the exact same thing. I hear black people talk bad about him all the time. And I guess the thing I would say for any of these people, Mr. Fuller, I hear people talk crazy about Mr. Fuller all the time. Black people talk crazy about him all the time. And the thing that I would say, if you are a non-white person, a victim of racism, white supremacy, before you open your mouth to offer a criticism, scrutinize any non-white person who is attempting to replace white supremacy with justice, you had better be ready to get off the couch. I'm saying that it's a big difference between knowing the path, walking the path. You want to go to the Matrix. It is a huge difference between sitting in the easy chair and talking about how dumb and stupid black people are, how dumb and ignorant Gus is, or President Obama, or Dr. Francis Cress Welsing, or justices and asking the right questions. It's real easy to do that, as opposed to getting up and saying, what am I going to do to solve the problem of racism, white supremacy? That is a whole nother ball of wax. So I definitely want to make sure I have that out. I'm not interested in feedback from anyone about my effort to replace racism, white supremacy with justice. And I would highly encourage any non-white person, if you are attempting counter-racism, do not listen to the peanut gallery. Non-white people, great spectators. That's from the code book, Mr. Neely Fuller Jr. It seems there is nothing we enjoy more than propping our feet up and talking about how dumb and ignorant and confused and backwards the Negroes are who are attempting to do something, replace white supremacy with justice, or attempting to be president and run things in a constructive manner. Nothing we seem to enjoy more than talking bad about them. I don't feel it's constructive. As I said, you can get up and do something. If you got that much know-how and that much intelligence about how this problem should be solved and what should be done, don't tell me about it. Get up and do it. If you think you can do a better job than President Obama, make sure your name is on the ballot in 2012. If you think you can run a better counter-racist program, I will gladly sit down, because it is not an easy task to do these programs without a phone or a computer. I will gladly sit down and listen to your broadcast and take notes. Please show Gus T. Renegade how it is done. I have no problem with that. I encourage anyone, if you are attempting to replace white supremacy with justice, just be confident in yourself. That's what all of this is about in the first place. Think for yourself. Come up with your own strategies, test them out, and be honest with yourself. If it's not working out, if it's not accomplishing what you want, you're not getting the results that you want, make changes. A lot of this is experimentation. I do that on the program all the time. I experiment, try things. Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't. You just have to see where it goes. But I don't listen too much to what other slaves on the ship have to say. Try and think for yourself. I think that would be most productive. And I can even plug The Godfather. I know that's one of the favorites. If you look at The Godfather, Michael Corleone is not running around asking everybody, Fredo, what should I do? Sonny, what should I do? Sit, think, make a plan, and get it done. That's what he does every time. He has Tom Hegan. That's about it. And even at times, he pushes Tom aside, like, I got it. I'm going to make my decision and move forward. We're always talking about The Godfather. Emulate Michael Corleone. You don't need to sit around and ask 20 other victims who are also confused about all this what to do. Think for yourself. Go out and get it done, and realize you're going to make mistakes. Learn from them, and keep it moving. Keep it moving. And definitely don't get caught up listening. You should expect lots of criticism. Don't get caught up listening to it. Just keep it pushing. Let's see. I think I had one other thing I was going to comment on, but I'm going to let it ride for today. I had one other thing, but I'm going to let it ride for today. I can get it another day. I'll plug my show before I open the phone lines up. Wednesday, we have a program, Dr. Mwali Baruti. He is a resident of Georgia. He will be on the program on Wednesday. The program will be... And you'll be on the program on Wednesday at 7 o'clock p.m. Eastern, 6 o'clock p.m. Central, and 4 o'clock p.m. Pacific. We'll be discussing, he's written a lot of books on racism, but we'll be discussing specifically his book, Homosexuality and the Effeminization of Black Males. Let me say that one more time. We'll be discussing his book, Homosexuality and the Effeminization of Black Males. He'll be on the program on Wednesday. I'm excited. Should be great. I know some folks are very familiar with this topic. Mr. Fuller, he actually had a pretty much a whole program talking about this back in October, if you want to check that out. I know Non Mighty Wick, he was the person who informed me about this. Thank you for the suggestion. If you have suggestions for guests, that's great. I'll take that. You can shoot me an email, untiljustice@gmail.com. But, yeah, should be fantastic. Cannot wait to spend the entire two-hour broadcast talking about homosexuality and the effeminization of black males. Lauren Ashley, she typed. I didn't get to what I was going to say on Friday about black pride being the ultimate oxymoron. I'll see if I can just say a quick word, and then I'll go to the phone lines. I feel it is a testament to how dishonest non-white people are under the system of racism, white supremacy, that the phrase black pride is uttered at all. I'm going to say that one more time just for emphasis. I feel it is really a pathetic illustration of how dishonest black people specifically are in the system of racism, white supremacy. The fact that the phrase black power exists at all. I got a psych degree. I'll take the Freudian slip on that, too. It might even be a testament to our pathetic state, the fact that the phrase black pride even exists under the system of white supremacy. Reason explanation. If Mr. Fuller is correct, and I believe that he is, I believe no one has contested what he said about black people being the most abused and victimized under the system of white supremacy. Tim Wise even brought research statistical information to bear that out, that the darker you are, the worse you will be treated in the system of racism, white supremacy. What power do we have in the system of racism, white supremacy? All of the people who believe that this black power and we're so strong, shouldn't be any discussion. You should be in Haiti right now. Black power should be flexing muscle like no other in the Caribbean right now. I don't see that happening. I see white people stealing kids, sawing off limbs. They had that on 60 Minutes. They had a white woman with a hacksaw sawing off a black person's limb. If there was some black power, you should be in Haiti right now flexing hard. Black power should have been in New Orleans flexing hard. I have seen no demonstration of black power. Black power should have been in Oakland after Oscar Grant was executed last year. Where are the Oakland Police Department? Where are the Oakland police at? Black power is here, and we don't stand for this. Sean Bell, you should have been in New York. Black power is here, and we don't stand for that. I don't see that at all. I see white power flex hard all over the universe. That's what I see every day. I could be incorrect, and I said I could do it in 5 minutes. Yeah. If we were really honest, I'm going to take this from Lauren Ashley because I thought this was great. She said it is a great illustration of how dishonest black people are, specifically the fact that black males are not honest with the black females that they are closest to. Make sure I repeat that again for emphasis. It is a testament to how dishonest black people are. Just looking at the fact that black males are not honest with the black females they are closest to. I'm sure there are exceptions, but I think generally you all can be the, if we're honest, you can just think about that. Do you think that's true? My experiences, it for sure is true. I'll go to the phone lines now. I'm going to 646 first because I'm just in a bad mood. I'm a victim. I'm a black male in the system of white supremacy.
Double whammy.
Exactly. That one wasn't clear. I'm going to make sure I get a clear one.
Double whammy.
Exactly. I'm in a bad mood. 646, you're not going to hang out on my line. If you have something to say, you can chat. If you're not going to talk, I'm going to be hanging you up so somebody else can call in. 646, do you have something to say?
Sorry, I don't have anything to say.
Okay. Are you a white person or a non-white person?
Non-white person.
Okay. Because you call the show a lot and you listen in, which is cool. But it does make me a little paranoid in the system of white supremacy to just see the same number on every program and they never talk. So I just wanted to check. I will leave you on the program. You don't have anything to say, you said?
Yeah, it was a good program. I learned a lot, though.
Okay. Thank you for listening. I appreciate it. Share with folks. If you all think it's constructive, please share. As I go to the phone lines, that is one thing I want to say. I want to repeat what I said on Friday. Not interested in a pat on the back or any kudos from anyone. I don't need validation for my effort to replace white supremacy with justice. If you think what I'm attempting to do here is constructive, just share it with other non-white people. That's what I need. I need non-white people to be less confused about racism, white supremacy. And if you think non-white people, as a result of listening to this program, they will be less confused, share it with non-white people. Put it on YouTube or Facebook or Twitter or all of the above or any other sites, GG Girls, whatever. I don't care. If you can get non-white people to listen, put it there. So if you think it's constructive, that's what you can do. I don't need anybody to, yay for Gus or give me any applause. Because I've seen the same people who applaud one week get angry the next week. So I'm totally beyond that victim of racism, white supremacy. Replace white supremacy with justice. That's what I need, not applause.
Double whammy.
Exactly. 980, are you there? Do you have a question, comment?
Yeah, Gus, this is Thomas.
Greetings, sir. How are you doing?
Good. I sent you a couple of emails. One to your blog talk, and another one to another means of conveying something to you. Because when Tim Wise comes back, if you get a chance to take a look at them, I think those are going to be some very constructive questions, if I'm permitted to ask them. I sent it to you because I thought I was going to, the last time I didn't get a chance to ask him, and he only gave an hour probably because I suspect he didn't really want to be subject to any greater scrutiny than he had to, so he made a short order of his visit. So there are like four questions that I had. I don't want to say them on the air because I don't want to give him the opportunity to prepare for them. I want to be totally impromptu, and I want them to be something that he can't really prepare for, even though he's very well versed in using trickery. I want to make sure that he doesn't have the opportunity to listen to this broadcast and then, have a prepared or canned response to whatever I ask him.
Oh, okay. I'm looking at them now. I think they're excellent. We'll get him on the next. He's coming back March 22nd, and he said we'll have the full 2 hours, so I will make certain we get them on the air. If you think it would be best that you call in and ask them, we'll do that. If you want me to ask them to just read them from the email, we can do that. But I will.
That's even better. You can ask him. I don't necessarily have to ask him. You can ask him, and depending upon what his response is, that will give us his bottom line.
Okay. Well, I'm looking at them right now, and I will. I don't care. I'll ask, or you can ask. The questions will be asked on the March 22nd broadcast. White people permitting, no problem. Your mic is still open. Mr. JJ, Non-Mighty Wick, Lauren Ashley, and Back of the Bus, you all have control over your own mic, so you can hop in if you want, if you have anything you want to share, chat about.
Can I be heard?
Yes. Is this Mr. JJ?
This is Mr. JJ, and, gotcha. And I'm coming in clearly this time?
Yes.
Wonderful, because we had a little issue last time. Just wanted to also say, yeah, man, I really, really was hoping to be able to ask Mr. White some questions. I got some really, really dynamite ones, if you can get him to come back and actually be open to some cross-examination from a citizen victim of white supremacy. That would be dynamite.
Yes, I knew today he was only going to be here for an hour. He said he had family obligations or whatever, but he said March 22nd we'll have the full program. So yes, just save him, and I will definitely make sure that there's time for folks to ring in with their questions on the March 22nd broadcast. So yeah, save him. You will definitely get an opportunity to call in and ask your questions on that program.
Awesome. And then I got one question for whomever out there wants to throw their perspective in. A question I started thinking about recently, and I don't necessarily claim to have a clear answer to it myself, but I'm collecting ideas. I wanted to ask everybody, what is their perspective on us African Americans, Black Americans here in America? Are we better off or worse off than most peoples in the world?
I'll open the phone line up to get a broader perspective. 111, you're on the line. 916, you're on the line. 404, you're on the line. In addition to Lauren Ashley, Back of the Bus, Non-Mighty Wick, and Mr. JJ, and Mr. Thomas, you're still there as well. Feel free, anybody, dive right in.
Greetings, targets. I don't really feel qualified to say if, as a Black person in this area of the world, I do live better than Black people in other places. I have observed that when you get further away from white people, it's a bit more difficult to get resources. And as we have incidents of violence among Black people here in this area of the world, so it is the case other areas. Often though, since there are more non-white people, it'll be a lot more non-white people being violent towards each other at the same time. So-called wars and whatnot amongst non-whites. But I do think Mr. White said in the program, to be white is a guarantee that you'll be treated better in almost any situation. I believe it'd be accurate to say to be Black is a guarantee that you will be treated worse in any situation. Just my two cents. Could you hear me?
I can hear you, yes. I can
okay.
hear you.
Oh, yeah, thank you for that. That's an interesting perspective, for sure.
There were some programs. Oh, go ahead.
Who asked that question? 646?
Mr. JJ, Rebuttal.
Oh, JJ. I noticed that when people go to India, they say, oh, these people are living on $1 a day, but they seem so happy. I think, which is a lot less than we make. And I was going to say that it seems like they have a perspective. They don't have as much money as we do. You know, they can't get their Burger King, their McDonald's, but they have perspective. They have a history. They have a name. We don't have that. So I don't know how you would quantify that, but I think that's the difference. That's why they're so happy with $1 a day, and we have jobs and are, you know, hypertension and the rest. And they don't have that. They don't have heart problems and stress and you know, those kind of problems. So there it is.
Mm.
I'd have to add a little bit. Oh, sorry.
I'm done. I was just going to say even Africans, you know, Indians, Africans, Asians, the Africans, they have their music. They don't have no money, but they have the music that they play, they don't just make up. That music is like 500 years old, and it's being passed down to them. So they have a lot less stress. They're happier. I'm done.
I agree with that statement. I also think that they relate to each other better too. I think that if I were to live someplace like on the continent, on Africa, I think I'd have more friends and less conflict with people that I do relate to. I think that there's probably less conflict between males and females. And then they have to deal with some types of racism, a lot of types of racism, but not the whole, like, in your face, like, relating to a white person and having that person look down on you when you don't actually live right next to white people. I think that helps a lot, too.
Yeah. You know, that's how I think that I don't know either, but it does feel like when you look at things, it seems like we may have more materially, but it does seem like we are more sort of terrorized, you know, constantly and in every which way, you know, crazy. Do you feel that we as African Americans, since we are maybe, I don't know, closer to epicenters of the white supremacy global power structure, that we have more of a responsibility than other non-white peoples of the world to combat racism, white supremacy? Any thoughts on that?
Yes.
I believe so as well. This is the back of the bus. White people consistently take information and keep it where they're located. I attend the University of Washington in Seattle, a very white area, very white institution. And the amount of resources they have there in terms of information is immense. And I do believe that the system of white supremacy keeps information from those who need it the most. And my ability, or the fact that white people let me access that information, I do believe I have an obligation and duty to inform as many victims of racism as possible in an attempt to replace white supremacy with justice. And I do think the same parallel can be applied to victims of racism who are in direct contact with white people. White supremacy is a global business, but as I believe it's Mr. JJ310.
Yes, sir.
As you pointed out, this area of the world does have very, very many white people. And I do believe that we have a responsibility, especially when we become aware of white supremacy, what it is and how it works, to change our thought, speech, and action to best replace white supremacy with justice. I mean, white people have demonstrated they have the will, or the ability, but not the will, but they're not going to stop, and that's been said on this program. So.
Yeah.
I wanted to add comments to what you mentioned earlier about Pride Renegade. It's interesting that black people are always saying black and pride, or black and proud and black power. I suspect that we did indeed have power or pride. And I'm using pride in the sense of when one discusses the unit of lions that function together to sustain their life, that's called a pride. We wouldn't have to say that all the time. And as you mentioned Haiti, the situation there, white people didn't say we're pride and whatnot, not. They made it happen. Hacksaws, rescue crews from all over the world, white people with guns stamping up and down the street, helicopters, and being impotent as black people. I mean, it's demonstrated we weren't able to help ourselves, basically. A pathetic position. And I do believe that it is a very, very good example of the dishonesty that black people have with ourselves.
Do you feel that we are completely powerless? And if so, how can we ever combat white supremacy if we are completely powerless?
I do believe we are powerless in the sense that we have much less power than the white supremacists. And when the white supremacists want to do something, it happens. It's demonstrated. We can change our thought, speech, and action to work towards justice, which I think is demonstrated on this radio program. And it's a matter, I believe, a big problem in trying to get to justice is that most non-white people don't know about white supremacy, that it exists, what it is, and how it works. So we've got to get more victims informed, and at that point, we can collectively change our thought, speech, and action with the common goal of replacing white supremacy with justice.
Do you feel that we are powerless, or that we do have some power? Power being the ability to do or act, to be capable of doing or accomplishing something.
The ability to act or do, accomplish something. By that definition, I could say we have some. But again, I don't want it to get confused in the fact that we haven't demonstrated our power to replace white supremacy with justice yet. Does that answer your question for you?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And that's my opinion. I'm a victim of racism. I encourage everyone else to you know, answer that for themselves. But yeah.
Do you think it would be productive for African Americans? Well, and not just African Americans, but since we're, you know, within this context, we're also probably talking about us, but all non-white people. But in particular, do you think it would be productive for African Americans to see themselves as powerless or having power to do or act?
In terms of being accurate, I do believe it's important to see that as individuals, especially being a black male, we are impotent. And that is because of the system of racism, white supremacy. And until that system is replaced, we will remain impotent.
Okay, so if we are impotent, and the system will maintain itself until we are unimpotent, if we don't have any power to act, then how would we become unimpotent?
Oh, no, I don't believe that we don't have any power to act. I believe, though, that to become not impotent would be to replace the system with justice. So that would be changing our thought, speech, and action, getting informed about what white supremacy is, how it works, so that we can be qualified to take it apart.
Fair enough. So you feel we have power?
Oh, watch the fair.
Some power. I mean, obviously, we're not as powerful currently.
For sure, by the definition that you offered earlier, yes.
And that being the case, I was going back to, because I think self-concept is important. Is it productive to look at yourself as powerless or as having some power to do or act?
I believe it would be productive to acknowledge that you have or as you said, the power to act?
Yes, the power to do or act.
Yes. But again, I do think it's important that you keep in mind just like how large this discrepancy between power and full or the white supremacists are and the victims of racism. They've demonstrated time and time again what power is and how they use it. And just in the matters of being effective, I believe it's best to be very honest about how we function in this system, about how dangerous it is, about how we don't have very much ability. I'm not saying that should prevent us from even attempting to replace white supremacy with justice, But I believe in terms of being effective, we must look at our environment honestly.
Environment. Hey, JJ, have you ever read that Sun Tzu's Art of War?
Yes, sir. I have.
Yeah, he says, know your enemy. And he gives out terrain was one of them. Your environment, what you need to know, and so you can, like, if this is a war, so you need to know what environment you're in. Yeah, for sure, I like that. Back of the bus just said, and I just wanted to say too, I had an uncle, man. He had like 10 acres, in one of those southern places. He's not alive anymore. But he had a street named after his last name. Also. But when he went to, it was a stream there. When he went, the white people had their cattle on his land, like grazing. Like, he wasn't growing no food on it, nothing. White people were using it to graze their cattle. And I guess with the fertilizer and stuff, like the soil was real good. So when you talk about power, you know, he had all that land, man, and wasn't growing no food. You feel me? And like Mr. Nellie Fuller said, he said it's our imagination, man. It's like we don't have, we don't have that idealism. Like, what do you want for the future? What do you want to do? What do you want to have? We just want a car, some Jordans, so we can pretend like, you know what I'm saying, we're better than the next person. Instead of having like a freight or a ship where we can go give our people rice or whatever we're growing, oranges and stuff like that. Like, we don't have that imagination to do that. We have the land and stuff. It's like right there. I got but nobody's growing nothing on the land that they have. The people in the third world, darker nations, they are looking to us in America. I went to the audience, they asking me all kind of questions about Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, the hip hop. They wanted books. You know, they try to tell us that all they want is genes. Nah, they wanted books on black struggles and stuff like that, all the history. That's what they're asking for. And they telling me that what they're going to give me in exchange is some peace. You don't have to worry about being around people that look like you over here. This is what we'll give you. And in exchange, we want books and knowledge about the system of white supremacy.
Did you have a question? I don't know if we missed you in the discussion. Are you there? Do you have a question? Your mic is open.
Unfortunately, Gus, I'm on speakerphone.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. No problem.
Did any of the female victims have anything to share?
No, I don't have anything to share.
I have a question. Because females, they be having kids and they're supposed to be more attached to their children than males. I don't know if that's true or not, but I would. Could you imagine if you could end racism, white supremacy, that you would have to kill your family? Would you do it if it would end racism, white supremacy?
Hello?
Yeah.
I don't have any children.
Yeah, I said, could you imagine doing it?
No, I can't. So I don't know how that. I can't really. I don't know.
Is is the question fielded to anybody or?
Please.
I would say I believe we should replace white supremacy with justice by any means necessary as soon as possible. And I do think a relevant question would be, are you willing to kill white people to replace white supremacy with justice? I'm not suggesting the victims of racism go out and do this, but I think that's another thing we could think about.
Well, the reason why I asked that question is because Tim Wise, he said that he wasn't really doing this. I was going to ask him that question. Would he be willing to replace, you know what I'm saying? If God said, look, man, I've been watching you, and you're supposed to be a counter-racist, and you know, you know how much you love your family, so check this out. Are you willing to kill your every blood relative you've ever met? And you do that, racism, white supremacy is over. Since he said that, he's doing this work for his family. He said he ain't doing it for black people. He said he's doing this for his family because he feels like his family is going to be in danger. So I wanted to ask him that, but because for me, it's a no-brainer.
Definitely. It changes the context a lot when you ask, like, it's a white person, you know.
Right.
Especially an admitted white supremacist.
Right.
That's a good question.
Because don't you think that in the end, if racism, white supremacy really was over, that's what he would be doing anyway, right?
Taking out white people?
Yeah.
I can see that as an option, but you know, I don't know if that's what it would be. I can definitely see it as an option. I suspect. I mean, if there were no non-white people present, I think white people would get pretty ugly with themselves. I mean, they wouldn't be able to say they're not white and we're white. I saw one movie in the Mad Max series, and I think it demonstrated that point. I didn't observe any non-white people in the film. But you saw a lot of white people just driving cars around and beating on each other, killing each other. I didn't mean to interrupt 909.
No, that's it. I kind of was going to ask you, but like I said, it's a no-brainer. I mean, I'm pretty sure every black person or I would say black in particular, you know, they would do whatever. If the creator gave them that option, they people wouldn't have to suffer no more and the rest. I think they would do it.
Yeah, man. You're a black male now, man?
Yes, sir.
Certain too, unfortunately.
Yep.
That ties in with the.
Hey, did somebody say that, or was that a recording? Cause
I think that's that's DJ Renegade.
Oh.
Mr. Who was it? The Judge Gray. He said that the guns in the war on drugs are pointed at non-white people. You could just say the targets. I mean. That was excellent today. Yeah.
And didn't, wasn't there a Seattle police chief that came on the show and said something along the lines of, the blacker you are, the more of a threat you seem to be to police and to the system?
Something to that effect, yes. Like the taller and darker you are, the more afraid the white person will be of you.
This was a white Seattle police chief, or former police chief.
Yes, he's former chief of police for Seattle. And he also was an enforcement official in California.
Norm Stamper. Check that out. October 5th, Norm Stamper.
Normie Norm.
Yeah.
Yeah, Seattle.
Hey, victims, do you guys feel that you have pride in being black, pride being a becoming or dignified sense of what is due to oneself or one's position or character, self-respect, self-esteem.
What do you mean? Can I get this clarified real quick?
Yes, sir.
What do you mean when you say black?
When I say black, well, right now in the context, I'm speaking of any black person in America is what I'm referring to.
You still haven't explained. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, so I let me put it like this. I'm meaning African American descendants, I guess, but at this point, I think it doesn't really matter. I think if your skin is black and you're in America, you're going to be treated like all the rest. So my definition will be any black-skinned person in America that has any African ancestry.
Okay. Now, see, this is exactly why I say definitions are important. Now, with the definition he just gave, number one, how black is black? Because if we're talking the color black, like a piece of charcoal, I've never seen any person on the planet who has black, quote-unquote, skin. If we go the African ancestry route, white people freely concede all the time. Everybody, every person on the planet can trace their ancestry back to Africa. That's why I say that definition really doesn't mean anything except these are people that the white supremacists have labeled as black. Tiger Woods, white people said he's black. He said, I'm not black. My mom is, you know, whatever, Thai or whatever non-black group that she's in. He said, I'm Koblen Asian. White people treat him like a nigger all the time. I hear white people reference him as a black person. That's what I mean about getting clarity about what these terms mean.
I agree. Very important. The reason I'm using that definite, well, and as far as Africa, yeah, we're all from Africa, but I'm meaning recent immigrants, and I guess I could be more specific. You're right, because sub-Saharan African, more specifically, more recent people that have more recent ancestry from sub-Saharan African, if we were going to be even better with the definition. So as far as people in America who have any recent ancestor, from sub-Saharan African that is black-skinned or has the potential in their genes to produce a more darker-skinned person relative to white. I'm talking about those people.
We did a show on that with Anthony Fabian about white people who produced a non-white child. Now, there's some suspicion about, you know, whether or not she had an affair, but it happened twice. For me personally, I think that's a tough one to believe, that in apartheid South Africa, a white woman had an affair with a black male twice, got pregnant twice, and then they went public and tried to get this child classified as a white person. I guess that is possible, but that's a lot to believe for Gus T. Renegade, and the fact that I've heard this incidents like this have happened before. So,
from my understanding of science, there's the dominance and recessiveness, and so it can skip generations. You can have two people who look like what most white people would classify as white give birth to someone who those same white people that decide the classifications would say are non-white. So I don't think that's actually that crazy or anything like that. I think that's how genes can function.
Right, but I'm pointing out what you said though was a person who is black who has the ability to produce offspring that would be classified as black. And what I only brought that up to say, they are all white people who apparently, the records indicate, have had offspring that other white people classified as not white, black in some instances. So I'm just saying according to what you said, it would not be a valid way to define the term black.
Well, what I said did not only include that statement. It was a comprehensive definition. So
right. And the first part of it included the skin color thing again. And I already said that also, to me, is not valid because there are people who do not have, quote unquote, black skin. I mean, how black are we talking? What is the threshold? How dark do you have to be? How light is the cutoff point where you get to be in the white club? That's what I'm saying.
Well, I mean, I kind of take a more postmodern look at words and definitions anyway. Words mean whatever they're pointing at, the idea that a word is pointing at. If people can come to agreement on that, that is more important than even the definition. And so I'm referring to African Americans. I think most of us know what I'm referring to. Not all of us. There may be some confusion, but I think most of us, when I say African-American, I think most of us know whom the people I am referring to, especially in this culture that really tries to let you know if you are African-American. So,
well, wait a minute. When you say cult, who is it that lets you know who the African-Americans are?
In our culture, in my opinion, I would say
anywhere on the planet.
White supremacists.
Well, I would say both. I mean, you put it this way. If I'm a white supremacist, Gus, and I tell you that you're an elephant, are you an elephant?
Yes.
I mean, they could.
That's a real question. I'm asking you for real.
In this system, white people have told non-white people you're not human, you're a monkey, and they have had the power to make it stick by putting you in a cage and that's that. Now, I'm not saying you have to believe it. Their system operates by deception, so they tell lies all the time. Wait a minute. And I'm about to stop this because I just want to go back to your original, because I don't want a whole lot of confusion. The only reason I'm even doing this is to really clarify exactly what I said on Friday. You end up with a lot of confusion around racial classification. I do not feel, and you can ask, there are a lot of people on the line. They can share their commentary. My view, I do not feel that you have provided me with an adequate explanation of what you mean when you say black, because that was what you started with originally. It moved from African ancestry to black skin, which was never clarified, to being able to produce an offspring that is classified as black. And I'm saying all of those things are arbitrary. All of those things are decided by the racist white supremacists. Now, other people, they might feel that the definitions that you've provided are accurate and that they do understand. That's fine. I'm just saying for me, none of those definitions prove adequate for the term black in the way that you used it. I would love to hear other people's perspectives, just because it might just be me. Maybe nobody else felt that way. Everyone else felt that you provided excellent definitions for the term.
Hold on.
Wait a minute. I want to get the other people's perspective.
Okay. Hold on.
Hey, Gus?
Yes, sir.
This is Thomas. To your point, I get the unfortunate opportunity to watch racism, white supremacy, because I work in the banking industry and I've been in that industry for 10 years. Now, there's something very interesting about mortgage law, that when we do an application, there's a process called the Home Mortgage Disclosure Act. Now, what this act says is that the following, that it is to your best ability visually to determine based on the classifications given by basically the white supremacists on how to classify someone racially. So, for instance, they break down if you're Hispanic or Latino, and then on top of that, they ask you, are you white, Caucasian? Are you Asian, Native American, Pacific Islander, black, which is a fallacy, African American, and then also there's one additional category that they'll put out there. Now, on the phone, the person can decline to answer the question, so they're not required to answer the question over the phone when doing the application over the phone. But when they're in the presence of a loan officer who is an official of the bank, such as myself, I'm a loan officer, I have to make a judgment about that person. I can either ask them or I can basically make a judgment. The point being is that while it says in the text of when we ask that question, we encourage you but don't require you to answer these questions to make sure that the person is in compliance with fair lending laws, I will submit that it does exactly the opposite, and here's why. In this whole foreclosure crisis, people who are non-white get foreclosed on two times more often than their white counterparts. on a percentage basis. So while you may answer that question on the upfront side of it, say, for instance, and they're saying they're going to monitor this to make sure the lender's in compliance, on the tail end of it, non-white people, it's almost guaranteed for the most part that they will probably not get a modification. If they get a modification, it's not going to go to a permanent modification to keep their home. So all these classifications come from, A, white supremacists, people who are in the power structure to make sure that those people continue to be mistreated.
This is actually in the manual. They give you the criterion for how to determine the racial classification of the person that's trying to get a loan.
What happens is you have to ask the person the question, and then it's up to them whether or not they want to answer. I'll give you an example. If someone calls me, and let's say, for instance, they are Filipino, that person who's Filipino can be Hispanic as well as they could be Asian. Yes.
Can they be black, too?
They could potentially, if they wanted to answer that way, they could. But now, upon sight, you know, either they, you can ask the question or you can simply arbitrarily say what they are. I understand. Like, I listened to your show, even though I didn't call in, I was listening to your show. And you're right, there is a lot of confusion about it because the way they've made it up, all these things were arbitrarily given, just like the whole, there is no such thing as a black person. Black is devoid of color, so it wouldn't be a color. So it just goes to show that they find ways to cause confusion by these racial classifications.
What happens if you go in, I'm classified as black. What would happen if I went in and said, I'm a white person?
If you said that you're a white person, then, you know, that, number one, that's if they ask you the question. Most loan officers in person, they won't ask you the question. They'll arbitrarily put down what you are.
Oh.
Ah, wow. See, that's the difference. Versus over the phone, I have to ask you the question, and then it's up to you to either decline to answer or to answer the question.
Wow. Would it be to the advantage of a non-white person to do the loan application over the phone and either lie about their racial classification and say they're white or to not answer it? Would that be to their advantage?
It's better to do over the phone. And it's better to, you can either, there's some people who are, that I know are white, that decline to answer. Very few of them. Here's something very interesting. Because like I told you, I'm doing a loan in your town on the Northeast side. And when you ask that question to a white person, they'll say, oh, I'm white. They'll emphatically say that they are white Caucasian with pride. Now, back to the other topic where we had Professor Judas be very discourteous to you on the other week. I had a situation where I had a white male, and, you know, normally, you know, you can go through the application or rifle through it and make an assumption that, you know, his spouse is going to be white. So he was in Virginia, was a disabled, what they call veteran. And when I asked him, you know, the race of his spouse, oh, she's a black female, black African-American female, right? Now, his subsequent response to me was, and I suspect that he knew that I was non-white, and this is the reason he said, for the most part, most people don't know what I am on the phone because I have a very common, quote-unquote, Anglo-Saxon name by the name Thomas Nelson. He said to me, yeah, a black woman with attitude, and then tried to come back and try to clean it up. And then try to clean up and say, well, all women have attitude. So just to Professor Judas's assumption that these are very happy and healthy relationships is absolutely ludicrous. She was being mistreated and didn't even know it. Just a little anecdote I want to share for
your listeners.
that in no way do I see these marriages as being anything other than legal, loving unions, and in no way do I think any of these marriages represent anything tragic. We should all be so lucky to be in relationships with people that love us.
Gus, may I revise my question?
Oh, sure.
Because, I totally, you're right. Race is socially constructed. Of course, white people, they definitely use terms to manipulate us. So, got to be clear. We got to be as precise as possible and make sure that our definitions are got it together. So, allow me to please revise my question. Victims that are on the line, are you proud of your heritage?
How do you define pride or proud?
I would use the same definition I used earlier. Let me grab it again. I pulled it right out of Webster's. A becoming or dignified sense of what is due to oneself or one's position or character, self-respect, self-esteem.
How do you define heritage? Sorry. How do you define heritage?
I give you the definition for that as well. This is from dictionary.com, heritage, something that comes or belongs to one by reason of birth.
Okay.
So, victims, do you have pride in your heritage?
I'm thoroughly ashamed of the things that we've had to, it's been a long time and we're still victims of racism. I define a pride as a unit of individuals that codify what is necessary to do in order to support their life. Black people have not demonstrated that. And by that definition, the only pride in the system of white supremacy is white people. And they never say they're proud. I mean, some of the overt racists, in my opinion, not the most powerful racists, may say, I'm white and I'm proud. But that's something, generally speaking, you don't see white people walking around and saying with their fists in the air. You see them going to Haiti, as Renegade pointed out earlier, with hacksaws, cutting off the limbs of black people. I don't know, and the Renegade also mentioned this to me as well, I don't know what really caused the earth to shake in Haiti. I mean, I think if we really sit down and think about how vulnerable we are in the system of white supremacy, and how deceitful the white supremacists are, like anything could have happened. They could have drilled and put an atomic bomb somewhere. I mean, I don't know, but just as an illustration of how vulnerable we are as black people, for myself, I feel ashamed. I do operate with the code and work to make that code more effective in replacing white supremacy with justice. I don't think we can have a pride if we don't have a code, and collectively we don't have a code. I do attempt to operate with the code, and Razzcast, he's a victim of racism, a black male. On one of his songs, he says, what's making six figures if you're, excuse the language, effing with bitch Negroes? Basically, what profit do you have to gain the world but lose your soul? Like, most victims, most victims, we don't have a code, so it's easy. I mean, the white supremacists may say, hey, go and do this, and we'll give you a little more resources. And it's been demonstrated. The black male that knelt down when Martin Luther King was shot, he was indeed working for the racist white supremacists. The black male, last name Roberts, that went to the side of Malcolm X when he was shot, was indeed working for the racist white supremacists. The only black male that Marcus Garvey trusted when white people started raising the level of resistance and accusing him of tax evasion and the postal fraud and all that, indeed was working for the racist white supremacists, specifically the FBI, and reporting to J. Edgar Hoover with information. I mean, we need a code, I firmly believe. I don't know if that answers your question, but...
I think so, but let me, if I may follow up, you're saying that you are ashamed of your heritage, that you are not proud of your heritage. Would that be correct?
Correct. And I'd say it's not even really my heritage. It's that of the racist white supremacists. However, there are victims of racism who have attempted to replace white supremacy with justice. And I do look at that as an example to myself. of what to do and also what not to do, because in those examples, I mean, we learn, we learn things to do and things not to do. But I don't think it's my heritage. Like, I feel like I'm a prisoner, and I'm not proud of supporting the prison. I'm not proud of the fact that my parents supported the prison. And I'm not proud of the fact that I didn't know that I was a prisoner until near a quarter into the way of my life, you know. Just my opinion.
Fair enough. And I was curious of what I wanted to ask that to all victims on the line. Are you proud of your heritage?
No, this is 909.
What do you mean by heritage?
Oh, well, we gave the definition earlier as, let me pull it up again. Let's see here. Heritage, something that comes or belongs to one by reason of birth. And let me say, let me tell you, I'm proud of all my ancestors. Every single one of them that, you know, did what they did to do whatever they needed to do to survive in life. And to
excuse me, can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
This is Mr. Nero. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir, we hear you.
I'm off the speakerphone. Let me preface what I'm going to say. I'm sorry to interrupt you. I've been working a lot of hours, and so I didn't want to, I was very hesitant to comment on anything because of how many hours I've been up. But this subject right here just disturbs me so much when I hear non-white people discuss heritage. Now, I just want to go back to what you said when you said heritage is, the definition is, I guess, something that you get from your birthright. Is that correct?
Something that comes or belongs to one by reason of birth.
Okay. Does language come to one by reason of birth?
It could. It can.
It could. Can religion come to one as, you know, reason of birth?
It certainly can. Absolutely.
So just those two alone, I mean, I don't have to go any further. Does diet come to one as a reason of birth?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
Does one obtain their diet, the food that they eat? Does that come through a birthright?
Yeah, it most certainly could.
Okay. So let me ask you, what language do you speak? Do you speak your birthright language? The language that you speak right now, is that your heritage?
The language
from your ancestors?
Right.
Yeah, the language that we've all been communicating with.
It depends on how far you want to go back. I would most certainly say it's most definitely not the language of, if I go back 5-6 generations, it's most definitely not the language of my ancestors.
Oh, so then you don't have that, do you?
I don't have what?
You don't have that heritage.
I don't. Oh yeah, I most certainly don't have the language that my ancestors a few generations ago were speaking. That has been lost, but I'm still proud to know that there was one, and I'm still proud of those people, and I'm still proud of who I am. I have
I realize. I'm sorry, young man. I don't want to cut you off. I realize it's a very painful subject for a lot of people. But the truth is, you don't have a heritage. That's
well,
the truth.
Why did you ask about different aspects of my heritage? That seems to contradict.
Hello?
From a logical.
Well, no, sir. I was hoping you would answer this question for yourself, because you don't have a language that you bring over as a heritage. You don't have a religion. You don't even have the food that you ate. I mean, you have absolutely nothing from your ancestors.
I have quite a bit from my ancestors. You're not talking about my ancestors. You might be talking about somebody else's, but you're not talking about my ancestors. I have quite a bit. You're right. I don't have the language. And you're right. I don't have the food, but I still have much to be proud of my ancestors, and I will be proud. I'm not ashamed of my ancestors.
I certainly did not suggest that anyone should be ashamed. I'm simply saying that these very critical things, language, religion, and diet, I mean, those are critical.
Well,
critical things. And I'm sorry. Well, let me just finish this. Because like I said, I haven't had any sleep. The way I see it, Mr. Fuller candy-coated it when he said we're impotent. I say we're destroyed. That's how I frame it. And the evidence suggests that. We are a destroyed people.
May I reply?
You may.
I agree. I mean, look, I wouldn't be on the line if I didn't think we lived in a global system of white supremacy. I wouldn't be on the line. I wouldn't be on the line if I didn't think that I and my people here in this country are victimized day after day after day. I'm angry. I'm mad. I hate white supremacy. But I don't have to hate my heritage. I don't have to act like I don't have any pride. I don't have to act like I don't have any heritage. I don't have to pretend like I'm completely powerless, because I do have power. And so do you. If you don't have power, you may as well blow your brains out now. If you believe that you are 100% impotent, or 100% powerless, you may as well slit your throat now, unless you think somebody's going to come and give you some pride, or give you some human agency, or give you some power. That's what I'm saying.
Is pride in your ancestors, can you tell us how that has helped you replace white supremacy with justice?
Absolutely. Knowing that many of my ancestors put up with such brutality, such suffering, yet were able, in spite of it, to carry on, to soldier on and give birth to me, that makes me feel like I have a heritage of strength. And that strength allows me to get up every day and deal with this global white supremacy system that comes at me from every direction. So yeah, I stand on their strength, my heritage.
Okay.
May I respond?
Yes, sir.
You said we should just maybe commit suicide. Is that correct?
I take that back. I think I was feeling a little emotional. I don't think anyone should commit suicide, but it feels like to me that you are committing menticide when you act like or when you imply that you are 100% powerless or 100% impotent. If you think like that, then you are. As a man thinketh, so shall he be. So when I hear people talk like that, my people, it really makes me, because I love my people, and it hurts me when I hear that, because I feel it's counterproductive. I feel it's unconstructive to buy into the lie that you are 100% powerless, or that you are 100% impotent. And if it were true, why are you on the line right now learning about white supremacy if you have no power whatsoever? I just don't understand that. That's all I'm saying.
I don't believe I ever said that
you were
100%
impotent.
Powerless. No, I said Mr. No, I said Mr. Fuller had commented that, you know, that we were impotent. I said that we are a destroyed people. But I didn't say none of that other stuff you mentioned. I just said that we are destroyed.
You said the word impotent, and impotent, according to the dictionary, means lacking power or ability. Now, you're right. Maybe I'm overplaying what you said. Maybe, I mean, certainly words can be a little complicated and semantics can have different meanings. And sometimes we say something that is misconstrued. But as far as any person that would say, I'm not saying you said this, but if we victims of white supremacy act as if we have zero power, zero capability, or say it or imply it, it's not true, number one, and it's not constructive, number two.
JJ.
Yes,
JJ.
Sir.
Yeah, how are you doing? This is Thomas. Are you familiar with the non-white, quote-unquote, would-be entrepreneur by the name of Robert Johnson?
Yes, I am. The former owner of BET.
Yes, and he's the owner. He's the so-called owner of he's the so-called owner of the Bobcats here in Charlotte, which is an NBA team, like expansion team. Now,
yes, I'm familiar with that gentleman.
Okay, now I want to make two quick points, and I'm going to leave everyone to finish. But basically, someone with less resources than him, apparently on paper, because they may have other assets, is telling him that his team needs to be sold. Now, he's in a town where he has basically a large enough market to where that team should be profitable, because there are other teams similarly situated in other markets that are making money. His team is losing money, and he's being pretty much forced by the NBA to relinquish ownership by the white head of the NBA. So that's one illustration. Now, this is a gentleman who was a billionaire. Half his fortune went to his wife because of a divorce, and then he became a billionaire again, and he has a franchise and is losing money and is being told that he has to relinquish it. Now, that's one example. Second example.
One example.
Let me finish. President Obama, quote-unquote, the leader of the free world, cannot get anything accomplished. Seemingly, anything that is really relevant and that can have some constructive value for non-white people, because seemingly Congress, namely white-haired white men, will not allow him to get anything done. Furthermore, when he went to Russia, a place that probably in his past, they were not considered necessarily white, now they are considered white probably by the rest of the world, no one shook his hand. So what does that tell you?
Well, I'd love to respond to all that.
Hang on one second. I wanted to check to make sure, because Lauren Ashley, she's also on the line. Did you have a comment that you wanted to throw in there? And then you can give your response, Mr. JJ.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am. We can hear you.
Well, I mean, it's kind of sidetracked from the question, so I guess I can wait till that's done. Then I guess I'll go back to the question.
I think essentially, you're pointing to the fact that there is a global system of white supremacy, which, like I said, you know, time and time again, I agree, there is one, no doubt about it. And so, yeah, I I'm not an expert on the Bob Johnson situation, so I can't comment. Obama, your comments on that, I would more or less agree with that. The last thing you said, as far as the situation with the Russians, actually that, from my understanding, turned out not to be true. That was taken from a particular angle. If you're talking about the YouTube clip where it appears that the Russians are not shaking Obama's hand, turned from what I've seen, and I could be wrong, especially in this system where you can be misinformed very easily, from my understanding, that was debunked. But yeah, we live in a system of global white supremacy. I understand that. I agree. I'm trying to combat it. But I'm just saying that you do have some power. You do have some human agency. You're not powerless. It's inaccurate to say you're powerless. It's inaccurate to say you're completely impotent. You have power. And we need to exercise it. If we're gonna win, we gotta exercise some power. We gotta think that we have the power to do so. Otherwise, why would we do anything about it?
Uh, Actually, Lauren and Ashley, do you want to share what she wanted? What she had it in mind?
The question was, do you have pride in your heritage? Hello? Can I be heard?
Yes, you can.
Yes.
Okay, yeah, like for a long time, I didn't identify myself as a black female. So, yeah. Even when it comes down, like Gus said, racial classifications are really confusing, so.
It is very, very confusing. Yeah. I suspect if there wasn't white supremacy, I wouldn't identify myself as black.
Exactly.
When I think of black in the system of racism, that's like, when white people say code black, oh man, watch out. They're going to destroy something, pull some guns to get down to business. Like, that just means destruction. And there have been white guests in this program that said black people are treated like garbage. And I think that's what black means. Mr. Wise said to be white is a guarantee that you will be treated better in almost any situation. I believe it's accurate to say to be black is a guarantee that you will be treated the worst in any situation, and my experiences have validated that. That's been consistent. And even the individuals I know who are also black, some that speak about white supremacy as a problem that needs to be fixed and some that don't, I can see the effects of just being a black person in the system of racism has on them. The stress, the health effects, the stress reactions,
the lunacy.
I mean, I think it speaks for itself. It really speaks for itself. And for me, at this time, like, look at images of black males. I mean, dresses. Look at the show description from Walima Baruti. Just the black male in the dress next to the white female. Tyler Perry films. Someone mentioned, I think last program, there's going to be a film with Martin Lawrence and some other black male actor dressing as females again. It's like, these are older, I guess this is being pushed as what I should aspire to be. These images are thrown at us every day, consistently, day in and day out. I don't think that's something for me. I'm saying to be proud of. I am working to fix the situation. For myself as a victim, again, I encourage independent thinking. I do believe it is accurate to say that I am powerless, but that does not mean I'm not going to work or think, speak, and act towards replacing white supremacy with justice. And for me, that really means, like, in terms of having the most control, that's over my actions. However, I still have to do what white people tell me. I still have to give white people what they want.
Well,
They can put you in greater confinement. The list can go. They can shoot you. There's a video actually published by a black female in New York called I Am Sean Bell, and she recorded 12-year-old black males speaking about how they felt after Sean Bell was shot. And these kids, speaking honestly, are saying, I'm afraid I could be shot right here and nothing would happen. This would just go on. And I think that's accurate. It's been demonstrated. There was a black male in Compton driving. Police see him, shooting him 120 times, shoot him 4 times. And he gets hit 4 times. And, I mean, he got a little bit of compensation, but can you imagine the trauma that you are faced with day after day every time you see an enforcement official? We can go on down the line. I have yet to hear of a case of black police officers shooting a white male for reaching in his pocket.
I hear you. We're terrorized and victimized. Agreed. But when you say that you have to do everything that the white man tells you to do, is that accurate? Do you have to? Because I just asked, or else what? And you gave me a consequence, which implies that there are two alternatives with regard to how you respond to the direction or directive or instruction of white supremacy people.
I do believe that all white people have to do what white people tell them to maintain the system of white supremacy. I think this radio program and myself speaking here is, I suspect white people don't want victims of racism speaking about white supremacy, what it is, and just dialoguing on how we believe we can end the system. But at this point, I mean, there's a long way to go.
So
I see what you're saying.
Do you have a choice in doing, if a white person, whoever this however it works, when it's communicated to you to act a particular way, when essentially the white supremacist system is instructing you to act a certain way, do you have any free will to disobey them? Now, I'm not saying there ain't consequences, because we know this sure is a long list, but do you have the free will to do so? And go ahead. Sorry.
No, you did go. Finish it.
I was just going to say, I mean, if we do have some free will and some agency there, then we don't. It's not accurate to say that we have to do whatever the white people tell us we have to do. In fact, I think counter-racism most certainly is mostly not doing what the white supremacy system would be wanting you to do, or would enable you to do, in most cases. Of course, we could split hairs and get semantical, but generally, overwhelmingly true.
Yeah, I think that's the goal of counter-racism, and I do have the will, but I don't have the ability to stop white supremacy at this time. That's what I'm going off of. Like, white supremacy still exists, and I do still have to do what white people tell me. I mean, there have been countless examples of enforcement officials telling me to get up off the train and give me no reason. A bus, again, happened, and I'm sure I could have said no, but I didn't want to get tased. I didn't want to get beat. You see what I'm saying? And this is not an isolated incident. This happens by the millions across the globe. And there are other instances. I mean, it could be white people say, hey, we're going to build a freeway right here, and your house could be there. Got countless examples of... go ahead, 909.
I heard the term... This is Mr. Nero. I heard the term free will, and I don't even see where you have that. You have their will. You have the will of the races. Proof of that is that we're still in a system of white supremacy. You don't have a will.
So essentially, Mr. Dan Nero, you have to do everything that the white man instructs you to do. Is that correct?
I'm not the only one.
Hello?
Yes.
Can we please, I'm just... It's just a request. Please stop saying white male. If you're going to say white male and white female, be specific.
I apologize. You're right.
Thank you. I'm sorry.
No, you're right. Sure.
We're interrupting.
You're absolutely right. Mr. De Niro, you probably spoke, but I got rattled there. Do you feel that you have to do everything that white people say, that you can never... go against their instruction?
I have not gone against their instruction. Proof of that is that I'm on this phone having a conversation with you. Now, when I decide I no longer want to live, that will be the day that I have exercised free will.
Okay.
But until the day I exercise my free will, I have none.
So the white people instructed you to call this program today about toppling the white supremacy system.
If this call would have eliminated the system of racism and white supremacy, that would be a different thing.
Mm.
But me calling does not eliminate it. It's not even a mosquito on its derriere.
Okay. As far as world empires have ever, you know, as far as all the world empires that have ever existed before this global white supremacy system empire that's currently in place, has there ever been, to your knowledge, a system that was replaced by people who did not feel that they had the power to replace that system?
I don't know. But let me ask you this, since you touched on heritage and how proud you are of it. Part of your heritage was the racists used to feed babies of your ancestors to alligators as bait. How are you going to get those races to atone for that?
Well, I'm not going to get anybody to do anything that's long gone, but as far as their,
Well, you touched on how proud you are of your heritage. Shouldn't you be willing to defend them and defend their honor? Because that's what the racists do. That's what they've been doing in Haiti for the past 100 years, is defending the honor of their ancestors. That's why the situation in Haiti is as it is today.
I understand, I want to say this. I feel like I'm defending the honor of my ancestors right now. And as far as Haiti...
Well, go feed some of their babies to alligators then, if you want to defend your ancestors. If you have free will. You can go to the nearest hospital and pluck out a few of their babies and go feed it to alligators.
You have free will. I'm not God, and I'm certainly not individually more powerful than the global system of white supremacy, or I would have already gotten rid of it myself.
I'm just asking you to go grab a few of their babies, since that's what was done to your ancestors. Since you got so much free will.
Well, I did have free will. Let me ask you this. As far as Haiti, the Haitians would not have ever been able to push out and get their independence. Not that they're... I already know the obvious conclusion. Of course, they're still under a global system of white supremacy. But I'm sure they prefer that they're not directly under the heels of the French before. And I most certainly don't think that they were able to fight against the French by thinking that they were 100% powerless. So if we think that we're powerless, it's going to be more difficult to exercise the little bit of power that we do have. I mean, look, it's David and Goliath, no doubt. But, David's got to at least think that he has a little bit of power if he's going to get off a shot to Goliath. If he doesn't, he might as well just go home and do nothing.
I wanted to, we're about to wrap up. I need like 3 minutes to wrap up the program. I feel like we've chatted about this a lot. I wanted to just throw out 3 minutes. If anyone wanted to share a thought on the admitted racist white supremacist known as Tim Wise and what he had to say, we can, 3 minutes. Share anything you like on that, and then I'm going to take three to wrap things up for the program.
Real quickly about Tim Wise, is his wife also an admitted racist?
I don't know. I don't know what his wife does. I don't know anything about his wife other than that she's a white person.
Okay.
That'd be a good question. Tim said white people have too much stake in white supremacy to be trusted, and I thought that was A+. He continued to say, judge them by their actions. And I thought that kind of dropped in the effectiveness, because white people can show you better than any non-white person can tell you. They have ability to go to the moon and back. They could get you a house tomorrow. But white supremacy could still exist. I just say, as long as white supremacy exists, do not trust white people and suspect them all. But I thought that was a good tidbit. And I was curious what tactics he was promoting that were dangerous to non-white people. Curious about a little more of the details regarding those tactics.
Probably protesting or doing some type of sit-in or something. I think Tim Wise is a deceiver, straight up. And I think that Dr. Bruce Lipton, he's a cellular biologist, like the top of the field. He said that the unconscious behavior is nothing but habit. Just something that you do, like when you're driving a car for 45 minutes, you're not really thinking about it because you've done it so much. So when they start talking about unconscious behavior, that's just habit.
I agree wholeheartedly. I think, and that's why I don't have a problem conceding that to white people. I think they just, you're so conditioned and accustomed to whacking dark people all day, every day that, I mean, it's just like, we smacked Toby again. I wasn't even thinking about it. Oh, okay. I'm sure that's how it is. I mean, when that's what you do all day, every day, year in, year out, I'm sure it just goes on autopilot. I've had white people tell me as much. I had an admitted racist here at the University of Washington. She said, I can't help mistreating non-white people. And she said it with a smile. She said it with a smile.
Tim Wise, I thought it was really interesting, in light of having read the ISIS papers, to hear him talk about white supremacy and use the term drop the ball at around 55 minutes. I'm going to go back and listen to today's program and flesh that out a little bit more and see if there was anything there with that.
More on Ashley? Anybody else? Mr. Nero?
Listening to Tim Wise is real similar to, like, I guess an organic version of a racist. It's so refined, so a part of him that he'll call it unconscious, but it's just like the caller just said, habit. And that's dedication too.
Mm-hmm.
I agree.
Was that, I don't know who that was, Mr. Nero or who?
Yeah, me either.
Yeah, no, I was going to share an incident from last night, but I will wait until you finish and do what you need to do, and if there's another opportunity for me to speak.
Program is Wednesday, 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Central, 4 p.m. Pacific. My final thought on the heritage, because I didn't answer the question. Lauren Ashley, go ahead.
Oh, no, I just want to know people's comment about the comment I made earlier about will you repeat it where black males are not answered by females? It's evidence of their impotence. I forgot how I worded it.
I think that's accurate. Dr. Welsing, in the end of her book, she talks about the foundation of any partnership between a black male and female should be replacing white supremacy with justice. Because if it's not, nothing else is consistent. I mean, if you're just disregarding the dynamic of white supremacy that targets black people the most, I think the description for the next program. Dr. Mwalimu Baruti's book is pictured in the right, and he has a target there, and the center of the target is black, and the outer ring starts as white. I think it's important for black people to be honest about where we are, specifically black males, black females, and if we were, things would be very much different. I think it's evidence of our position and our predicament that we're not honest.
I guess my closeout would be, I don't believe, or at least I'll speak for myself, I have never said that non-white people cannot replace white supremacy with justice. If I believe that, I would not be doing this program. I definitely think non-white people can choose to attempt counter-racism. I definitely believe that's possible, or this program would not exist. If I was going to sum up my thoughts about power or powerlessness, at the end of the day, whatever power any non-white person thinks they have in the system of white supremacy, I would strongly suggest that they keep their frame of reference to whatever power they think they have in relation to how much power the white people who practice racism, white supremacy have, so we can keep this power in perspective. If you feel that you are not powerless, you feel like you have a lot of power, just keep that in relation to how much power white people have in the system of white supremacy. And my final thought on pride or heritage, I hope there are no black people in Haiti right now running around with shirts from the Haitian Revolution or pictures of Toussaint Louverture talking about their pride in their ancestors. I hope that is not happening, because I strongly suspect that is not going to solve any of their problems. I have seen no evidence that having a lot of pride about what a dead victim of racism, white supremacy accomplished or said, does anything to solve the problem of racism, white supremacy. And Mr. Muir, we have to catch you next time.